It's happening. Listen, before this episode starts, we just thought we'd make a little clip to let you know that anyone who doesn't know, we now have a Patreon. It is patreon.com/anotherone podcast. And there's like a few different tiers on there. And we can go and get where you can sign up to us. And it helps us make this podcast. Helps us make it, helps us pay for the podcast. Helps us make it better. Helps us improve and put more content out. We've got big plans for things we want to do. Haven't we? Since
yes, we have. We've got big plans. We have got big plans.
Yes, Rob. Yes.
No, we have got big plans, and without anyone signing up to the Patreon, this will die.
Yeah.
This will go away eventually, because if we can't make it work financially, we can't keep doing it, can we?
No, we can't just keep throwing fucking...
No, and we've got Aftermill to buy, and that fucking costs
a bomb. We've got kids to pay for, and listen, if I can't provide, I'll leave.
Yeah.
So...
And we already know...
You don't want to make an orphan.
We already know how it's going, don't we? So we needed to be giving us something back.
Yeah, please.
Because we're bleeding here.
My kids are begging. My kids begging.
So sign up to the Patreon, patreon.com/anotherone podcast.
That's it. There's three different tiers, loads of different prices.
Pick one.
Help
sign
us.
Up. You won't even notice it going out your bank. It's a couple of quid.
Less than a Tesco meal deal. Oh, well, maybe more than Tesco meal deal.
You'd buy a starving man a meal deal, wouldn't you?
Yeah, well, I'm starving.
That's what we are.
Look at me.
Look at him.
I'm
do you think
stop.
That? Do you think this?
Help! Another one. Hello, what's happening?
Hi, everyone. Welcome to number 46 of another one. Number 47. Patreon. With me,
this is
number 48.
64.
There we go. Right. Way off, wasn't I? 64 of another one with me, Simon Wozniak.
Might have been 63, but go on.
Rob Thomas.
Hello.
And today we've got a returning guest. Who've been you're most capped.
Most capped.
Most capped. James Allen.
Loyal.
The Jamie Carragher.
Available.
And then and then
5 minutes away.
And then a debutante.
Yeah.
Katie Mulgrew.
Sure.
What? Then you are a debutante.
No. Yeah. No. All that. Why? Makes me sound very sophisticated.
You look defensive here. You got your arms crossed.
No.
You
I'm
didn't
not.
Like the fact that we called you a debutante. What's up?
I'm not. I was fascinated by. Simon's incredibly enthusiastic intro.
Yeah,
why are you taking over that role? I'm
a bit under the weather, and I like your frames.
Oh, thanks, mate.
For the non-viewing listener, is that what? Katie's got a very in-your-face set of frames.
What type of frames are they?
It's noisy.
I'm waiting to see this. I want to see you describe them to the audio listener.
Horns,
without being offensive.
Horns. That's a
They're more winged.
Winged. Is that what it is? Winged.
Yeah. I've got quite a noisy face.
Right.
I've got noisy glasses.
Take away from the face.
Yeah. To make the face seem less loud.
Right. Okay.
I'm having a noisy face. It's good for comedy.
A noisy face.
Yeah. It's like, oh, it's a lot.
Have you had
There's
that
a lot
before?
Going on?
A noisy
no,
face.
No, I just, it's the way I describe. Just well, because I've got a lot of facial expressions. I find I can't not. I'm just very expressive.
Right.
Everyone in my family is. We've all got big, expressive, noisy faces.
Have you always had like thick rimmed? Dare I say it wouldn't be ostentatious, would you? That's not the right word.
They're very ostentatious.
Are they?
Yeah, they're extra. Okay. Yeah.
Have you always had glasses like that? Or
no.
When did you?
Well, that's why you're trying to dance around. I know. This is what it's like. You know what it's like right now.
No, because I've just got these, haven't I?
Yeah. What made you jump into the spectacle realm?
Oh, God, I just realised I'm the only one not wearing glasses.
Well, I had thick rims, didn't I, for a while?
I feel like a bully.
And then...
This is the first time I've seen you wear glasses properly.
Yeah, because I had my nose job, didn't I? So I didn't wear them for like a year and a half.
Yeah, did you have a rhinoplasty?
Septo in the middle. Anyway, it's well
seriously?
Trodden. Yeah, me inside of my nose is all fucked. I mean, face is still fucked
did
now.
One gig,
like,
did one gig with Reginald D. Hunter?
No,
thought he's going to be famous
Casey,
and got a
no.
nose job?
No.
It was. No,
what are you trying
right.
to insinuate no, there with that noisy face no. of yours?
See, I told you. No, just it's like a Danielle Westbrook.
No, it's not a to do like that
situation.
It's not a Danielle
that
Westbrook.
I mean, for anyone who's under a certain age, they will have
Christmas,
no idea
Katie.
What I'm talking about. So you just enjoyed. I just thought.
No, it's just it just happens. People have people have them all the time, but they just never know.
Right.
You just can't breathe through one nostril and then...
Oh, no.
Your adenoids. Is that to do with that?
I think they're somewhere in there.
I had them taken out.
Well, your adenoids?
Sinusitis a lot or something. Yeah.
No, I had it.
Did they give you a dead low voice or is that just pitch perfect lying to me?
Right. Well, no. I had them taken out because I had a weird when I was about 10, for some reason, my nose just grew like a weird...
All grew.
It grew like a weird growth at the end of it. It looked like I had a permanent bogey. It was like a spiky, like a weird little spike that came out of my nostril. And people would be like, Katie, and they'd try and say, wipe that. It's got... So I went to the doctor and said, no, it's got like a blood vessel in it. Your nose has grown that.
Like a pile.
Like a nose pile. So I went to hospital to have it taken off. And then when I woke up, I felt so rough. And I said to my mum, like, I feel off. I feel like I've been hit by a train. She went, oh, well, while you're under, they just asked if, like, wanted your adenoids out. And I thought, yeah, just do that as well.
How old were you?
I was 10.
Oh, so she consented for you?
Yeah, she said, yeah, sure, take them out.
So what is the point of getting them out?
I don't know. I just feel like my mum thought bargain because it was like a private hospital. Yeah, I think she thought, sweet, mate, two for one.
Right.
I'm not even going to question whether they're bothering her or if it's got any medical benefit. Just whip them out.
Is it free?
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, when I was doing my research, there was something I do recall reading about adenoids, but I never really looked into it. Couldn't be asked.
Right. I only know them from Pitch Perfect. That's literally my whole.
Oh, yeah. Does it make you snore? Did it make you.
Yeah. I was snoring and then just. The breathing was bad as well. And then they did it. And it's all right now.
What? Better. So, like, really heavy. So, if you were, like, walking behind someone.
Well, just if I was like, asleep, then I wasn't that bad. But it was just the snoring.
If I was a woman walking home alone at night and you were behind me before you had your operation, what's going on?
It's just the snoring was a bit of an issue. And then it also affected my sinuses and that. I had the cold horrible, and it kept.
Horrible that.
Did you have to have a big bandage on your nose for a while?
Yeah, it was awful.
Could you not gig?
No. But it was so terrible. Like, when I didn't realise that when they did it...
Why are you laughing at his misfortune?
I didn't,
it's funny, isn't it?
I didn't realise...
Because he's miserable anyway. You can just imagine him lying in hospital going, oh, for fuck's sake.
I didn't realise that, like, you couldn't breathe through your nose at all after this operation. Like, I thought there was going
to
be
So you've gone from one nostril to no nostrils now?
Well, listen, I went through it and I thought it was going to be like, oh, they're going to just like stents up there or something. I'll be able to get a bit of air past. No air for like a week. And that was the most stressful thing I've ever had. Because if so, you did this now.
So you week, mouth breathing
that,
for a week.
Yeah. That, like, that's,
was it stressful? Do you feel like you're drowning sometimes?
You couldn't shower because you got this thing on. You're always nervous about knocking it. So you're just a sweaty, horrible mess for a week. I was going to make a joke there, but but then you just, it's just, and then you can't breathe. And then it got to a point where, like, I'd look up and I'd see it, and I was actually picking away some of the blood with, like, a biro lid.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you were a scab picker.
Well, it's just because it was so terrible. It got to the point where I was like, I don't even give a fuck if this works now. I was literally like,
what it off.
I just want this gone now. Like, it was so,
How did that affect your ability not to wear glasses? Did you not balance
because
on your nose?
Because everything's so swollen. I'll show you a photo of me. My whole side of my face all
so
swollen.
Were you
there.
A lens man?
I was a lens man, yeah. But I couldn't wear glasses at all.
Oh, okay.
And did you lie about what had happened? Did you tell people that you'd, like, saved a child from a burning building and knocked your nose out?
No, I was too past it then.
All right, okay.
I don't spread the rumour that he had it done cosmetically.
Yeah.
Oh, did you?
Yeah. Sadly, it
was. As soon as a guy had to have a nose job, everyone I spoke to.
It wasn't cosmetic.
Was he thinking he's going to be famous, you know?
No, I don't think. There was no cosmetic value in it. And if he has, he's done a terrible fucking job. a lot of nose jobs are people correcting a bad one.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that when people? Oh, well, that's the thing, isn't it? People go to. Is it? I think people go to Turkey for nose jobs and teeth implants.
Yeah.
Going to Turkey for your teeth
your
is
head,
a big
and,
thing,
and
isn't
your hairline.
Mm. Oh, is it?
Apparently, you can get the whole lot now. So, like, I've been.
What? Like,
I've
three
been
for one?
Holiday.
My mum should be thrilled. She loves the bargain.
You get your hair done, your teeth done, and you can get a tummy tuck at the same on the same time. Come back a new person. So I'm literally. I'm thinking about little Turkey because my dream, Katie, is to. Go be the fit dad of primary school. So on the playground,
what?
Dropping the kids off.
What?
And having all the mums.
And
all
the mums talking about
you. Yeah.
You want
I want nothing more in life than all the mums to be looking at me as I drop the kids off, going, oh my God, isn't he amazing? So I thought about my lad's two now. A couple more years, I might go to Turkey, get the whole lot done in one go.
You want to turn up at sports day with your traps out?
Yeah, just.
And like, along
on the school run, do you perv on any dads?
No, because.
No. Too busy? Bother?
No, I just, well, I'm always late, so yeah. I've always got to do the walk of shame at reception.
Sign him in.
Me and my close personal friend, attendance officer Angela.
You're like late, so they have to go through the reception.
Yeah, like nearly every day.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
What, have they called you in on that?
No, they're really kind.
No passive-aggressive remarks?
No, I'm quite lucky because the quite, I don't know what it is about primary schools or Catholic primary schools, but the reception ladies are quite frightening.
Yeah.
But if you're lucky, you'll have quite a charming child. So they all love Jim.
Right.
And like he's charmed them just because he sings to them and stuff.
Right.
So they're like, oh, Jim, we love Jim. So they'll give you a pass, mate. Yeah. If you, they'd be like your kid.
But he's missing phonics there, isn't he?
Oh, he's fine.
He can't be missing phonics.
What's phonics? I haven't got to that level
yet. Got
phonics. Don't. It's a political hot potato. It's basically they're going
to
read like Siri.
Your salt.
Is that what they do in Register now?
They don't learn. Like, you know how we read? Read a bit more like flowing. Yeah. They will just read like where they don't really like that Neiman's eyes like that.
Yeah, no, it sounds like someone's turned the volume on and off. Like,
so you know when you're reading on Word when the woman goes, we went to the park for like that. Yeah. I think it's that. I think. I don't know, to be honest with you.
I think it's hard.
I don't go to the assemblies.
I love you. Just sneak in. Just want to make sure this is a...
Sitting there like, I know what the fuck I'm talking about. I ain't got a fucking clue.
So you've heard her say. I've heard her tell her mum this, so I'm assuming that's what she must be on about.
Yeah, well done. V8 at bar. Yeah, see you later. Oh. That's enough of that. Three-letter words, innit?
But no, there's not... It's mostly mums on the school run. Mm-hmm. There's not that many dads to it.
That's why it's great when I've got a bit of me set, haven't I? Well, how good it is being a dad. Because my dad's generation was shit at it. The fact that I'm present is amazing.
Oh, yeah. So, like, the bare minimum you get absolute kudos for.
I go to a music class in Formby, which is neck of the woods middle class. Me, 12 middle class mums. They fucking love me.
I bet they.
There's also an Instagram model that goes there. That's way fitter than
him. He's went once and
he's gorgeous.
I had a panic attack. Because it's me and 12.
You and James.
I was texting him going, you're not going to fucking believe this. Some absolute Greek model has walked in the music class. My music class, by the way.
Yeah. I know.
This is my turf.
Because I used to just turn up like a tramp and they'd love me anyway. So I turn up in like shorts and like just me sliders on. Never make an effort because too easy. It was too easy. And now I've been dressed to the nines every class.
To the nines.
He's not been one.
Because also, if they're all middle class, they'll be like, oh my God, he's like a working class dad as well. So like, it's like all that generational trauma. Yeah. He's not going to...
If I know Formby Katie, I don't think they are.
I think you also assume I'm a drug dealer. I think that's pretty much what they assume.
They're like, elbowing each other like, what if you ask him? There's a mum's night out at Christmas. Ask him. Ask him if he knows anyone. Yeah. Ask him if he knows someone. Get us a couple of grams.
Yeah.
In the WhatsApp group for the mums.
Yeah. Who's going to ask him? Sarah, you ask him. All right.
It probably is going to come now. Oh, I just realised. Yeah, because I've been to two different... I've been one to Crosby, which is also a bit middle class. But Crosby's a bit closer to where I'm from, Bootle. So it's a little bit rougher, whereas Formby's a little bit posher. And the Crosby one, as soon as I was in there, they loved me from day one.
Yeah.
This Formby one took them a few weeks. It was like, why is this dad not working? You could tell he were judging me. That was the first thought, was like, why is this dad not working? He were judging me. But now I'm one of them. They love me now, so it's great. But it's brilliant. I love it. Not last week, the week before. So they always finish with a little flute. All the kids pretend to be asleep or they have a little cuddle. So me and my lad, we have a little cuddle while they do the flute. And it's always a song, you know. It's like Imagine or... Somewhere Over the Rainbow, something like that.
From the tap.
I got it. What are the people that runs the music group?
Yeah.
Oh, so like they'll play the flute?
Yeah, and all the kids will be like, either lie down or with the parents.
Like the Pied Piper.
He falls asleep. Yeah.
I mumble along to whatever song it is because you always know, like, roughly know the words. Yeah. So I'll sing to him, mumble along. And then the patriarch is alive and well because this woman thinks it's incredible that I do it. And like 2 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago went to me, Rob, oh, you're brilliant. You're brilliant. Oh my God. It's so important that children hear men sing. Men don't sing enough. It's so important children hear men sing. And I'm sitting there going, yes, it is. Thank you. And then one of the mums goes, oh, you know, she, like to one of the mums, is a professional singer. And the lady runs class. Oh, really? Oh, you'll have to give us a song. And Rob, why didn't you give us one as well? And they're going, what?
Why is it
I'm going to give a song. This one is a professional singer.
Why is it important that kids hear men sing?
I don't know. I just took it.
Because maybe there's this like gross misconception that, singing's for puffs, yeah. Right? Right, like, yeah. So, you know, heterosexual
My dad
men
never hugged
sing.
Me after I was 8 because he thought that was for puffs. So.
And he sing at the footy.
Yeah. Only sing when you're winning.
Yeah. Yeah. But you should just do that. Then they're like, sing a song, just do the most offensive football chant you can think of.
Get your sword out of focus and pitch.
Get your tits off. Get your tits off. Get your tits off of the dad. Get your tits.
Because it's nutritionally beneficial, you should sing that. Because it's nutritionally beneficial for your baby.
Yeah.
That's a good football chat.
I just love the fact, it was the fact that someone, like professional singer, who's in a quite a decent, what are they called? Christmas plays. Pantomime. Who apparently is in quite a decent panto this year. And she thought we were going to be on the same level just because I was a dad. And I was like, this isn't happening.
There really are like... There's definitely slower standards.
I love it. Like I say in my set now, before I had a child, I used to consider myself a feminist. Now you can go fuck yourselves because I enjoy the patriarchy too much now. I'm sorry.
I've benefited it
I've seen the good life and I don't want things to change.
I know, it makes me laugh when it's like, when someone sees like Lee, my husband, like, oh God, he like, you know, picked the kids up from school. He's like such a great dad. I'm like, yeah, mate, that's like, I'm just making sure they're like, they're at home and are safe. That's kind of like, I think that is the bare minimum, I think. Yeah. Just making sure that you pick them up from the place that they were.
As long as
sure
they don't die in your care, you smash it.
Well, you know, Mike, I love calling myself the primary carer because I have them 2 days a week.
How are you, James?
Well, a childminder always picked me up with a bunch of other kids. So whenever my mum came, it felt like a bit of a treat.
Right. Or like, yeah. Okay, yeah.
It was like, oh.
Yeah. Well, diminishing returns, like we said on the Patreon. Don't celebrate Christmas too much. Don't pick your kid up too much.
Don't spend
otherwise,
too much time
that'll
with
stop
them.
Being a thing.
They'll become entitled.
Yeah.
So you'd be like, yay, mum's here. But also my mum, because she was single at the time when I was in primary school. All the other mums were kind of like,
your mum's the kind of woman I wanted to be talking about me in the playground.
Yeah, all the other mums were like, "Oh, you're a bit not with a man."
Oh.
And then it was like, "We're not gonna let our kids play with him because he's clearly not in a stable."
Felt like you couldn't play with the kids because they thought your home life
and
was
shit. They'd like put like when we were saying something, I was older, like they'd purposely not invite me to stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know if that
seriously,
was
this the 50s?
It felt like
back
it,
in the day
the
when kids
so,
learned.
Yeah, the wheel's very like clique mentality. Yeah.
Yeah, mums are savages. Oh. He's a savages, aren't you?
I don't know, it's weird.
You are.
You're in any cliques?
I'm in like far too many WhatsApp groups.
Oh, yeah.
And all sometimes, related and to... also I get worried that I'm gonna post in the wrong one.
Yeah,
because I've got like the close circle of like there's like 8 of us, and then there's like the year 2 mums.
Right,
and then I've got an enemy on there who started on me at a party.
Started on you?
Yeah, another mum started
like
on me
physically
at a party.
Or like passive aggressively.
Well, like right in my face.
Wow.
Yeah. At a kids' party.
Yeah. So while she was starting on me, there was like a magician in the background. He was doing
John Holt.
It was that social club in South Manchester as well. Oh. So
was it someone's birthday or was it like a general party?
It was a birthday party.
Oh no.
It was mad. And what? Then, but also I didn't back down because I know I'm quite middle class, but my Rochdale like kicked in and like she like squared up to me. It was like, you've been laughing while your 7-year-old was stomping on my 2-year-old's head. I was like, well, that didn't happen, mate. Like. That just didn't happen. You tell him to keep his hand to himself and then marched off and then I followed it. It was like in a club. I was like, excuse me.
So hang on, where
I'm not having this, yeah.
Where was it? I guess.
A social club, yeah.
Oh, wasn't like a soft play sort of thing where like...
Oh, no. Although I have seen it kick off at a soft play. There's a really rough soft play in Stockport and I saw one mum say that she's going to bang out another mum.
Oh,
it's amazing. There's like South Manchester's got he's either got the most poshest soft play you can ever go to. There's a place called Head Over Heels, which is like chandeliers, and it's insane amount of money to get into. Or there's like the opposite end where
it's
really rough, like it's feral.
I've seen someone who's misses a teacher in SCEM, and she had to have a meeting with this parent because other parents were threatening the dad, saying, "Watch your back. We're all going to come and bath here because of the way his kid was treating the other kids."
Yeah.
Scam, isn't it?
Have you had that yet?
No, because you're supposed to do...
You get like, oh.
Well, you're supposed to do everything through the teaching staff. So you're not... Because that was what this... It turned out this woman who scared up to me, she was annoyed about something that happened in reception, which is, by the way, 3 years ago. She
stays with something, you, though.
It was something that my kid had done to her in reception. Right. And she was annoyed that I'd never, like, WhatsApped her or messaged her. And I said, yeah, because we're not supposed to. It's like safeguarding. And she was like, well, I would have found your number. And I would have messaged you. I was like, well, that would have been inappropriate, mate. Like, that, no.
So it was something to, that fight you almost had, was that, it was, sorry, because I'm a bit weird with this. So is it a kid's party?
Yeah.
And no one was drunk?
I don't know. I wasn't drunk, but there was alcohol. You could available. Go and get a beer. Right.
Okay.
Yeah. And it's, you know, it's a Catholic mums and dads.
Right.
Like second generation Irish people mostly. So, yeah, there's probably a lot of booze.
That a bit of, right, okay.
There was another party that I wasn't at, but one of the mums had turned up at the hall and was fuming that there was no bar because she was like, this party's about 4 hours long and why is there no bar?
Right.
So she left, went to Sainsbury's, came back with two bottles of Prosecco and some plastic cups.
Oh, nice.
That was good. I wasn't there.
I respect her for that, though.
I absolutely do.
I went
no,
to
you can't be bringing alcohol. If it's not there, it's
B-Y-O-B.
Not there.
BYOB. BYOB.
Nah, I think you're fine.
Maybe or B, who knows?
You're fine. Go and get your own.
Hey, if it's not a drop-off, I think you should have the opportunity of, like, you either drop them off or BYOB.
I respect that. But if it, I had a beer on Sunday just because, I'll sit through this, gotta have one. Went to Santa Stories on Sunday.
And like,
so, there was beer available. So, like, I'm gonna have one.
Is that the one that the lovely Gav Cross does from Funny Looking?
No.
Oh, no. He does like a Santa Story thing.
Does he?
Yeah.
Oh, no. It's just I have nothing to do with it. It was in a tent in Prescott. It was lovely, but I didn't have anything to do with booking it. It was just
I think it's the same thing. But I love that. Do you find that your Google Calendar just gets booked out full of?
Oh yeah, but we had to have a Google Calendar. I had my wife telling me, and then I go yeah, sound, and then I don't realise these things have happened. So like, the 18th we're having a comics drink, and I've been moaning because. People who were organising it were like, oh, yeah, we're going to go to this at this time. And it was like too late for me. I was like, no, day drinks for the older ones who need to get off at a decent time. We need to start earlier.
Yeah.
So I was like, no, day drinks. I had a little moan about it. Everyone already thinks I'm a bit of a bully. So I'm bullying these to get my own way. And then it turns out when I sent you, oh, by the way, 18th December, comics drinks. Yeah, we're going to Farmer Ted's to see Father Christmas that day. So you won't be going there till like later on. So I'm like, oh, for fuck's sake.
My favourite thing about that was when you said everyone thinks I'm a bully, I looked over at Simon and thought, I expected him to see what like women do to each other, like, no, babe, no. No, don't say that. Who's saying that? Don't listen.
I can't hear him anymore.
You were just absolutely silent.
I just
silent.
Wait till everyone stops looking at him and go, he stopped talking now.
White noise.
James.
My mum made a teacher cry once.
Oh, go on.
Sorry. Don't,
no, go for it. Onto that. Bringing you in.
When I was in year six, there were two lads who I don't know what the other one does, but one of them now is a Union Jack as his profile picture on Facebook, so obviously going very well.
Your age?
Yeah.
Judge for yourself.
Solid.
And I don't think investing in crypto worked out for you, did it, mate? But he
it's crashed that now, hasn't it?
Yeah. Glad. Him and this lad. I had braces.
Yeah.
When I first got braces put, and they tried getting a magnet and try and stick it to my braces and then try and drag me around the classroom.
Right? Did it work?
No, because they've obviously watched too much Tom and Jerry.
Yeah.
And they don't know what physics is.
We're both sitting here thinking, why didn't that work? By the way, just to explain your level.
I told a story thinking, man, they're not going to be in my corner, are they?
Right.
And. At break time, they upgraded from a magnet to two AA batteries and tried to sort of see if they could sort of charge or like get a reaction off the metal in my teeth.
How did you let this happen?
I'm a very, look at me.
You're just there going.
Oh my God.
Did you go along with this?
The magnet thing, I was like, oh, this, because there was a girl fancied on the table. And I was like, yeah. Oh, she might, you know, might be quite funny.
I find it funny.
Magnet mouth.
Magnet mouth, Alan.
To a pum pum.
might get invited to a birthday party and get a little party bag or something. Didn't happen. And then at break time, they had sort of like pinned me against the fence.
Oh,
and
no, that's prized, too far.
Prized my mouth open. And
that's horrible.
I reacted by
pinned you against the fence. Two of them.
Yeah, yeah.
And we just
so prize.
How was you the only one with braces, or the only one that they get away with doing it to?
Well, I think because I was. No one in my class had them at the time. I was kind of like showing them off, like, oh, look how cool I am. Like,
right.
Oh, you were early to braces. Yeah.
And I got I could choose the colour and everything. I was like, oh, look at this. Like,
right. Cool. Oh, this feels like you were asking for
and
it.
And then.
You absolute victim blamer.
Well, he just said
he was going to go around with braces in his mouth.
What a selfish.
He was showing them off. And then he said he had his own colours.
He deserved everything he got.
Once he said he had his own colours, I was a bit like, oh, you prick.
You did.
Self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah.
And
what colours did you have, by
I had red first because I support Liverpool.
Well, yeah, because if you wear red braces, then you are
top and bottom.
See?
Or see, if you got them pink, would have been fine.
Top and bottom brace? Full mouth?
No, just top.
Train tracks?
Just top.
Just top.
Yeah, right, okay. Bottom.
Meh.
Bottom's
good, that. Look as scary. Like, wait, do the bottom ones as well. It's annoying how you have one brace. What the fuck? Just put the other one there for show.
I've got braces. Look.
Oh, have you?
I got a bottom brace.
You're going to drag your hands on.
I got pink.
Oh, they pink. Just look normal.
I literally got
them. They match your gums. I wouldn't have bullied you for that.
How long have you had them for?
Since she was 14. Like
a few
yeah.
Only a couple of weeks. Never had them out. But they like cut in my mouth to shreds. It's a nightmare. I'm having top ones put on, though. Like,
oh, you have the full
weeks.
Rack?
Yeah. And I'm getting vectored, like, ick. And I'm like, put back together. Anyway, I want to know about your mum making the teacher cry.
Getting
pulled around by a magnet softly.
Didn't work. In your head, it's funnier. Yeah.
But it's like one of the ones that
you got funny. You sad, think, sad, really.
You think of like
was the magnet just not strong enough, or was it never work? I don't know why it didn't work.
You're that much of a loser, not even your braces are magnetic. Yeah.
Oh, you've got a weak jaw. Yeah.
Come on, what happens?
Well, you're like thinking this is like the fucking roadrunner, like there's this massive magnet.
No, right, the magnet thing, I thought. I just like the ingenuity of children.
But the battery, that's like...
The battery.
You can't jump start Alan.
How old was you?
10.
See, that's quite...
And I'd already been circumcised twice.
It's good thinking for a 10-year-old, though, isn't it? But that is good thinking for a 10-year-old. Let's get two batteries and see what we play.
See if we can jump...
That's the kind of thing you expect a 13-year-old to come up with.
Jump leads.
Yeah, that's really stupid.
Around my way, they were
really stupid children.
At 10, if my lad was like, oh, yeah, we got two batteries, like, oh, you're playing with electrics, I like that. Well done, mate.
Yeah.
You would have been proud. All right, good.
No, it's not nice. Yes. It's not nice, is it?
Yeah.
It's not a nice thing to do to
yes,
someone.
Yes, he is in hospital, but you know how circuits work.
Yeah, exactly.
Did
you earth him? No, that's your problem.
Did you earth him? Is he pat tested?
Yeah.
I took my shoe off in retaliation. And just lobbed it at one of their heads.
That was silly. You've got to keep your shoe now, aren't you?
And then, well, they ran and told the teacher, and then I got in trouble, which is always the injustice
of the injustice
like
of the world.
That. It's like, but Mr. You and I brought my mum, and my mum like takes talking like no shit.
Yeah,
and good girl.
She took what? Sorry,
good girl.
Yeah. Good girl. Well, the voice I'm about to do, yeah. So she's my mum's from South Auckland,
Jamaica.
No, yeah. Mum's from Trinidad. Mum's from.
Yeah, what began on the school? Sorry, I don't know. Can't carry on.
You're bullying me, son. Yeah. No. I can't do it.
Go on.
I've seen a lot of Top Boy. She's from South Auckland in New Zealand, and where she grew up was proper like rough. So when she gets angry, she turns into that like
Kiwi.
Yeah, proper like
boss.
Spitting sword, just like anger, and she went like, tell me what's happened now. And the teacher told and said like, oh, well, James's version of events is this what happened. And then because they tried to put like magnets in his braces, and my mum went like was shocked. And then there was like a silence, and the teacher went, you've got to admit though, it was quite funny, wasn't it?
Wow, it's one way to deal with it, isn't it?
And my mum went, what the fuck did you just say? How fucking dare you? How fucking dare you? My son is in bits over there. I tell you what won't be funny. When you get your P45 in the fucking mail, you fucking witch. I will go to Ofsted. I will rip out your fucking throat, you whore. And my dad was like, no joke, come on, leave. And my mum like proper went to town on her, and great, she was visibly tearing up and crying, and she went, no, no, don't, no, I'll sort it. Didn't get bullied for
a week.
I don't think my mum made me cry, but I think if anything ever went wrong, or like I got upset about something, like there would be a very like 360, like a turnaround, because my mum's Northern Irish, so similar like the accent is.
Yeah,
like, he did not fuck with Mae Mulgrew.
Yeah.
She was like, yeah, she was, yeah.
She chased when I went to school in New Zealand, she chased a bully around the field with a flip flop after school.
How long was you in New Zealand for?
Just under a year, but yeah.
Managed to get bullied in that time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Look at me, Rob.
I know. Sorry.
Were you never bullied?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we're all comedians. Yeah. We've all been bullied. Yeah. Like,
why are we all sitting here?
I laughed at my one, so it never felt like bullying.
Yeah.
No, I you think bullying. With them, like. No, I'm always conscious about saying I was bullied, because real bullying's horrid, isn't it? I never really felt like I was like bullied. Yeah. Like,
what, you know, like
some people bully is like, that's not even, that's horrible. Yeah. That isn't it. I never really had that. Mine was just the odd dig in the thigh at CDT, like, ah, fuck, that it. Do you know what I mean? It wasn't like I never had like a sustained...
Like targeting.
Yeah, misery. So yeah. I never really liked to go, I was bullied, because I think it make light of somebody actually got bullied, because I think that really does fuck me.
I always felt mine was my fault as well, because I was a very try-hard kid.
Oh.
So I was always trying too hard to make people laugh and stuff. And instead of coming across like a knobhead.
Oh, I love that. Self-inflicted.
So it was self-inflicted, yeah. Mm, so,
deserved everything you got.
Yeah, but you don't see that at the time, do you? That, like,
no, you just think I'm trying to be, yeah. I just
want
to
be cool.
Like, you?
I just want to be cool.
Yeah.
Again, I don't know whether, you're right, I don't know whether it was like targeted, but I just had like some very I think I just had some toxic friendships.
Girls, though, innit?
It was really, there were some really toxic friendships, girls, and that's why I think, as a grown up, I've been very lucky. I mean, maybe that's just a subconscious of like picking the right people. But when you say like the WhatsApp groups, like the mum WhatsApp group, I mean, they're just the most like nicest, supportive, loveliest women.
They'll be killing you behind your back.
Wait till one of your kids starts excelling, and then you're gonna be
fucking like seven of them, and they're just not got me in it.
Yeah,
when they talk about me.
As soon as one of your kids starts excelling, that's them gone.
I had a Facebook group,
cut them out.
A Facebook group made about me when I was in year 8. Had like 30 members in, just taking the piss out of me.
So horrible. Yeah. I'm so glad.
I was before all of that.
I was way before. Am I the oldest one here?
Then how old are you?
37.
Yeah, I'm 35. He's 33.
31, you cheeky cunt.
Although, lads, I was at a Premier Inn on Friday night, and yes, I got ID'd.
Same.
I got ID'd.
ID'd?
Yep. And I was really impressed, because I thought, I'm 17. And he said, no, I thought you were under 25.
Right.
I was like, I'll fucking take it, mate.
Yeah.
Was you hamming the braces up there? Was you like, can I, you know, greasy?
A Premier Inn, very nice. Whereabouts?
I was in Glasgow.
Family room? Or was you on?
Oh, no, I was in the bar. Right, so
did you have a family room?
Irish family came over, but they always, like, whenever they come over to Glasgow, where loads of my Scottish family live, or Manchester, they always stay in the same hotels because they just don't like change.
Yeah. Oh,
okay. Because I said to my auntie, I said to my sister and her wife came over as well, I said, have you seen much of Glasgow? Like, have you been out to like bar? No, just been in the Premier Inn bar.
I like that. Just, I respect that.
They are like creatures of absolute habit. Yeah. Just like, nope, just going to go downstairs.
Why would you go anywhere else?
I would just stay in the Premier Inn bar.
We've been on Aldi, the same place I've been in the past 15 years.
Yeah, then.
I'm a little bit like that, though. Once I like somewhere, I'm always tempted to just keep going.
Do you fear change, Rob?
No, I fear not having a good time.
Oh, I get that.
That's my bit. I fear being let down. So
FOLO.
Yeah. It's not really FOLO.
FOBO.
Fold.
Fob. Fobble.
Yeah, fold. Let's call it fold.
Fold. Let down.
Yeah.
Silent B.
I get the same food in restaurants.
Or whatever.
Or the same takeaway.
Yeah.
Like I would go the same Aldi every year.
Do you not get a buzz though when you find something new or go somewhere new and you're like, spots. Oh, this is the new place I'm going to go to. But then do you ruin it by going to it then?
I've been to Lagos in Portugal 3 times.
Is it Argos then? I've ruined that now.
Yeah.
Got you all a pen?
Yeah.
Come on, kids, let's go. Saturday.
So holiday wise, I'm not too bad. I have been to that too many times. That's because it's a little weekend break. It's easy to pick and go to. I've been to lots of different places holidays, but I am very much restaurants, same food, takeaway, same thing. Always all
right,
the same.
So like different cuisines, you'd always have the same thing.
Well, Nando's always the same order. Different, yeah, different.
What's Nando's?
Half a chicken, and it's either two chips or rice and chips.
And hot, or extra hot, or
medium. And then I put garlic sauce on it, which makes it hot.
Oh, I'm a lemon and herb wanker.
Go on.
Is your fear the fiscalness? Because that's what I worry about. I worry that, like, I've wasted all that money now.
Mm.
I should just go back to, like...
No, never the money. It's right. Just... I think you're limited, aren't you? You can only have so many experiences in life. So if I want them to be bad, that's one experience.
God, you've made this so existential.
That's just me.
Yeah, but do you not think... Like, do you never think, oh, what if I'm missing out on something better?
But like you say, better. I'd rather have a good time than not have
a new time.
I'd rather have a good time.
He's got sayings like that around the house on pictures. I'd rather have a good time than a new time.
Yeah. I play that to comedy.
I just don't like the risk. I don't like the risk of not enjoying something. I just...
But does it make like worry you though? Do you get anxiety about it or not? No, not to that extent.
Why would I get anxiety about it? Because I'm just going to do it. So
yeah.
I think you need to roll the dice. I'm trying to roll the dice a bit more.
What you suggest them roll the dice on, though?
If someone went to go to a restaurant.
Yeah.
I don't roll the dice, but you should.
Rob, tomorrow we're going to see Christ the Redeemer.
Yeah. In Brazil, I'd do that, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
But it's, like I say, it's more restaurants and things.
Okay, right.
It's more like food and things, like the kind of easy things to control. But I go to new places.
Oh, okay, cool.
I don't know.
We'll go Ben Brazil.
Yeah, Ben Brazil's not as nice, but yeah, we'll go to Ben Brazil. Cool. You can try everything. That's why I like tapas and stuff, because I can take a risk of tapas.
Yes, yeah.
I will take a risk of tapas because I've always got the fallbacks.
Yeah. You can like, oh, well, I have that octopus tentacle, but I've got Bravas coming though, and I'll enjoy that instead.
Well, I'm the opposite of the fiscal thing, but I'll overorder as well.
Ah, right.
So saying only...
I want to go out
saying only
a
six tapas, I'll have like nine tapas, just because I want to risk having something new.
Yeah, I'll go to certain restaurants with certain people because I like to be enabled in my eating too much. So I have to pick like if I want to go for tapas, there's like a certain friend I'll know that we'll both be like, oh, we could get three we could get four and then maybe like some bread.
Right.
Why don't we just get five? Oh, yeah, we should get five. Like, yeah, people.
My tapas behaviour, and I don't know if it's cultural or not, but I've told myself it's cultural, so it looks good. So what I do is I show the three at a time. And that way, no one ever judges you. You can have as many as you want. Because three come out and they take the three empty plates. So you always only look like you're having three. But you could have 9, 12, and no one ever knows. Only person knows between you and the waiter, and they want a tip, so they're quite happy to run the bill up. Because if they're thinking 10% of the bill, they're loving it.
Love it. You never really got it.
Lunya or Salt House?
I'd get Lunya over Salt House.
Yeah.
But Lunya's gone downhill as well.
Has it? I've not been for a while.
So salsa's nice. It's originally from Crosby, just opened on Castle Street. Very local information for you.
Anyone's listening to this in like...
Tourist board.
Amsterdam. Do you have many Dutch listeners?
I don't know. You know, we'll have some, I think. We've got some from
Iran. That's where we get a few.
Yeah, we have got quite a few in Iran. Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah, we've got quite a few in Iran.
From Tehran, giving it a little...
Iran.
Yeah, but Tehran's the capital.
No, they're from Iran, these, mate.
Yeah, but that's within Iran. I'm pretty sure it's Tehran.
No. They listen from Iran. Shut it, braces. Do you want a mince pie?
No, I don't like
it. I know you don't, but I have one. It'll be funny.
Is it all that stuff you do about hating women, guys? Is that why you've got a big base in Iran?
Maybe. Possibly. Yeah.
Possibly the toxicness.
These guys know what's happening.
These get it.
They get it. They know.
Yeah, you're going to go out, like, you know, comedians go out to, like, the army camps. You're going beyond that. You're going to, like, the cave. You're doing it to the other side.
In the caves in Afghanistan. She's like, I like gas.
Yeah. I heard a joke ages
ago. My wives!
Take my wives.
I heard a joke ages ago about that. People saying they did a gig to the people and the troops in Afghanistan. And then the twist is, it was for the Taliban.
Right.
Oh, ages ago, I think it was at Baby Blue, and I was watching. I'd never done stand-up before. Right.
That'd be my nightmare, that. So, James, we've booked you. Oh, hey guys!
What?
Just sort of like raunched up like sort of squaddies, like proper alpha.
Right. Yeah.
I was gonna say, I'm sure you could relate to the Taliban because you're just like talking about all your bad experiences in the West. You also got bullied in school. Wouldn't happen to you in Islam, mate. We don't do that. We're quite charitable.
Yeah. The only release is death when you get the promise of 72.
You know, it'd be really weird then if like 2 weeks time. Someone on like a forum goes, has anyone heard from James?
Yeah.
Like, does anyone know where he's gone? He got radicalised by Rob. He's actually gone to Afghanistan.
Rob made a fair few points about the West that James got on board.
Rob, yeah. He's had his citizenship revoked. It's really escalated.
Just James with his arm around Shemima. I think we should let her back in.
Where is she now?
I don't know.
I don't know. Has she had a citizenship? Returned? I don't know. I feel like we shouldn't talk about things that I'm educated about.
We only
get our information from
doubles down on that.
I feel like I should probably read some stuff about this before I share.
Should we have her back or not? Answer now.
We don't want facts.
Answer now. Whatever you say, I'll go with you. Yes or no?
I don't know, Simon.
Shit out.
You sell your mate now. Go on.
I'll have your bank if you've got £10 Patreon and you're in. I'll sort you an agent to get you out.
They do a Patreon poll.
I saw it.
And send it to the Home Office.
Yeah. Like, I reckon I know what that'll come out as. I don't want to do that.
You know what the worst thing is? The only thing I know about Jemima Begum is that I saw her on Twitter a meme where she was fit. So that's it. That's the be all and end all.
What's mean?
I've like, I just saw a meet. I just saw someone post a picture of her and go, like, hold on, hear me out.
Potential.
All your patrons would be like, let her back in.
That's what I mean.
Show us what's literally under the hijab and then we'll talk.
Is it like when Skepta posted that picture of Pretty Patel? What? And it was just Pretty Patel in the House of Commons and he was like, but like, seriously though. And everyone was like, oh, you know. I was like the Matt Hancock and I'm a Celeb thing is like, yeah, that doesn't excuse.
Yeah, well,
the horror
he did all right, didn't he?
What? I didn't watch any of it.
I haven't really watched much of it, to be honest. I watched a bit, but
I don't normally agree with him.
So many people.
I don't now. Piers Morgan.
You know what? We all make mistakes. We all make mistakes. He weren't too bad on that.
I did like stupidly read some comments, and yeah, there was a lot of that, and a lot of like, well, you know, like.
It
was a really difficult time, COVID. Yeah. Could you have done any better? And I feel like we should just all move on. I'm like, what? But also, like, the thing that I haven't moved on from is, didn't he give his landlord a contract for PPE that was millions of pounds?
Yeah, but who wouldn't?
This is the thing on this pod is that we're both Labour, but if we were in their position,
we're
behaving like them.
A little bit of honesty.
Just go.
I've got a couple of cousins getting government contracts. Yeah. Right, that's all I'm saying. Maybe not to their level, but everyone's getting looked after.
Right, what level then? Like, oh, maybe like 100,000 contracts.
Just so they can live comfortably.
All right.
Just so when it comes to Christmas, I'm looked after. That's all.
You know,
we
red.
All like to think we'd be this fucking guy that's even and fair, but when you're there, you go,
you're not red, you're not blue. Makes me get you purple, which is the colour of UKIP, which fits into your previous conversation quite nicely.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't like UKIP. Got grown too fond of Turkish barbers.
What?
I don't know what that meant.
I've grown too fond of the Turkish barbers, so I can't get behind.
I thought you meant they'd like endorsed him or something. Yeah. Like, you were like, no, I can't.
Don't want them kicking out. I thought
you were saying you hated Turkish people. And
no,
I was like,
no.
What's Rob just outed himself?
No, I want them to stay. That's what I'm saying. It's the only time in my life when I feel respected, looked after, and
what are the barbers?
Vulnerable. Yeah.
What do you mean? What do you go in for?
Shave.
What, like the whole? Like,
do you massage your head?
Do you do the hot towels?
Do you set fire to my ears? Do you wax my eyebrows?
What do you mean? They set fire to your ears?
Do you set fire to your ears? They get a lighter and they.
Mad thing in the Turkish.
Flick your ear and burn the hairs in your ear, so the hairs don't stick out your ear.
Alright.
Bit of wax up your nose, pull that out. A bit kinky. Didn't realise into that, but
you get your eyebrows done as well.
You get my eyebrow just dap it. Gets waxed as well.
The mono.
What's your barber's name? Plug him.
Mahmoud. C4 Froden. Really, it's amazing. Hemna's the barber.
You're talking with him with such like affection and fondness.
I love him. The only problem is, it's never the same one. So I can never really grow a bond with them. But all of them are good at it.
I think
so
there's a reason for that. Like, oh God, Rob's coming in. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Right, your turn, mate.
Just a heavy breathing over the top. Yeah, yeah.
Do you feel like you've... Seth Rogen there? Do you feel like you've found your barber? Because I...
Oh, yeah, I know which one I want to be there.
Right.
But he's only ever been there twice.
Do you not ask for him by name? Is that creepy?
Well, I think it's creepy, but also...
You're too much of a man. To be like, I want
Because I feel like I'll ask on the other ones. Like, I'm not giving them a chance. It feels a little bit racist. Like, no, that one's all right. The rest of you can fuck off.
But would you be like...
So you're worried that they might think that you...
It is awkward cheating on your hairdresser.
Yeah,
it is awkward, yeah.
Would you be like, in the same salon?
I found my place. I could get haircuts from here for the rest of my life and I'd be fine.
Mm. Yeah.
Because I went to that...
Well, you found the place or you never found
I have now, but I went to that Barber. You know, in Liverpool One.
No.
And they when they first came about, like 6 or 7 years ago, they prided themselves on being women.
Oh, I remember, a men only. And they had to take the no women out, didn't
And the guy who ran it was like, you know, like a proto-Peaky Blinder kind of thing. Yeah. That became your dar. And I went in there to get my haircut before my sixth form prom.
There's always a tinge of sadness with anything you ever do. Just always a tinge of...
Ask me who I went with.
Who'd you go with?
Ex-girlfriend. Okay. So I'm in the chair.
Says no women, doesn't it?
No, but...
Are they allowed to
go to the prom?
Right.
I went on my own. Another tinge. More of a hue now. I sat in the chair. He's like, what's the occasion? I went, oh, it's my sick form prom tonight, so you don't want to... He went, oh, right. He goes, go with a girl. I went, yeah. He went, any advice? I went, what do you mean? Do you have any advice on, you know? Okay, sit. I went, no. And he went, mate. And I went, what is that? Stop
gun
now.
Signs.
Stop the haircut now.
Why?
Did you really?
And then he went, that's all you need to know. And then he just carried on cutting my hair. Pure silence all the way through. £35 for that advice.
Did you get a haircut?
No, sat on the table on my own, waited for my mum to pick me up.
Wait. So you didn't even get...
That wasn't the intention. We just went because we ended up being good mates. But I had a dance with my English teacher, Mr. Robinson.
Mr. Robinson?
Yeah, yeah. My hero.
What sort of dance?
James. Just sort of like...
What was the song?
Oh, you went holding each other?
Blue Monday by New Order.
Right.
Don't know it. You weren't holding each other. No, it was just like you danced with each other.
Well, I later saw him on a night out.
I think it was ironic.
I saw him at the Jacaranda in Liverpool a few years ago, and I...
Did you repeat?
No, I was very drunk, and I went, you changed my life. And I went, if it wasn't for you, sir, I'd been, you know, stuck in a dead end job. And he went, there's still time, James. And then he walked away. And it was like, oh no, you.
I mean, that is funny, but also just like ruined your hero worship.
I was like, oh, God.
Why was he my captain or captain for you? So
because
much?
We used to break time, we used to have conversations about the Smiths, and we chat about like all music and stuff and poetry.
Oh, he seems really dodgy.
No, he was lovely. He's
no, no, come on. That's all cliche stuff that older boys say to younger girls to sound like mature.
No, he was generally a big music fan. We'd have chats about I was the first person to give him.
I love that you would just assume that anyone that's got an active interest in James is a predator.
I was
come on.
He obviously, mate. Yeah, he was trying to groom you, mate.
If you had a teacher that was talking to you about the Smiths and things like that, you wouldn't.
Music to my ears. I was the first. I gave him Wu-Tang Clan debut album on CD and went, listen to that, and he loved it. He used to swap CDs and stuff. It was great. Good fun. And then he said that, and I was like, oh, it's taking the shine off it a little bit there. Cause
it has,
Your teacher did stand up, didn't he?
Like he didn't. We've mentioned it on the previous podcast. Yeah, let's not. I'll tell. If I'd arrived for the Patreon early, what a deep dive. But yeah, I.
Right, okay.
They asked me to come back once, you know.
Well, you schooled him?
Yeah, and they were like.
Have you ever to do a talk on stand up?
Yeah, and I went, I'm not. And then the teacher went, James will be more than welcome to sign any.
Oh my God!
I'm doing Beat the Frog.
It's like they just want to keep humiliating you in school.
I'm like, I'm less than a year in.
It never ends. There's like some bowl of a soup, man.
It was like 2016 when I first started. There's someone now who's like 16 who's got my signature in their planner.
You went back.
Oh, bless
I went
you.
Back twice. Yeah,
you cheeky bastard. You went back to school to do talks on stand up.
The first year of it, went back just, and I was like, I felt bad.
You piece
I,
of shit.
You know, I felt bad for saying no. I was like, oh, they've done a lot for me, and I was like, you know, built my confidence and all that kind of stuff. I'll do it as like a nice gesture.
How long have you been doing stand up for?
A year.
Wow. What is the school's problem?
They have no one.
Well, he's offended here.
I was the success. James Allen doing 2 minutes 47 at Beat the Frog.
Was that a big success?
This was a success story.
I don't think it matters how successful I get. My school will always be ashamed of me, I think.
Have you ever been asked to go back?
No.
Did you go to a posh school? You middle class, or was it just more Catholic than posh?
No, I did go to a private school, yeah.
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 Your dad, has he ever gone and give a talk to kids?
I don't think he's ever been asked to go to like back to, because he's from Cookstown, just outside of Belfast, and then but he moved to Belfast when he was like I think six or seven. But yeah, no, I assume he's been asked to do.
I haven't done my research, so forgive me. Jimmy Cricket.
Yes. Yeah.
That's not the real name, though.
No, it's Jimmy Mulgrew.
Obviously not.
No, it's Mulgrew.
Where did you get that from?
Cricket. I have asked.
Just a quirky name. Like Jimmy Cricket.
Not just Jimmy Cricket from
Pinocchio. I think he just wanted something funny. I think he did go through a period of time. Like, I have seen some old stage photos of him, like, wearing oversized wicketkeeper things.
So did he ever do, like, circuit, like, club things? What's he do? Does he still do it?
Yeah, he does. But, well, because when he started, it was the 70s. So he was doing the social club. So you
just
would
joke,
go,
like a bag of jokes thing. And then.
Yeah, just like props and like proper old school. But like you would get booked to, a bit like, you know, getting booked to go and do like the stand for a weekend. Yeah. You would get booked to do, but like a week. So you get booked to go to Newcastle and do a week of shows at like a.
Right.
All different social clubs.
Well, no, sometimes just the same one, because that's where people went. Like people didn't go to comedy clubs, they would go to social clubs or theatres. And people didn't go on holiday that much either. So a lot of times, because that's why when I was a kid, we used to get packed up and taken to like various.
Whatever Butlins, me dad's playing this weekend.
Well, it was summer seasons. So he would do a massive 8-week summer season from July to the end of August in like Torquay or Paignton or Great Yarmouth. So we'd pack up the whole family and we'd go and live in a house for 2 months. And the same with pantos. So like you'd go and do a panto for 2 months and we'd all go and live in like Darlington or
Just imagine like
summers though. Summer
some people have summer seasons in
summers
Vegas. You got
I
it in Darlington.
It stopped when I got to about 12 because summer seasons just died out. People just weren't going because people were going abroad. Mm. But when he did them for about 20 years, because, you know, and he did Blackpool so many times, like, you know, headlined like variety shows. These were like big variety shows where he'd be like the headline guy.
Right.
And they'd have, I mean, mad stuff, but brilliant. Like they have a magician and they'd have a female singer and then they'd have like a double act or a triple act. But like there's like 10 people on the bill and then always like some dancers as well.
So when it became like alternative or something, like is it the 80s or like alternative?
Yeah.
Did he ever go into that circuit and that?
No, not really. I mean, he has done clubs.
That's what I mean. Was he sort of like out of it by the time it even became a thing? Well, alternative.
Well, he was on telly. Like when he was most famous, was probably between 82 and like 94. So he like he
so
had
when
his own
were
like
born, basically.
Yes, yeah, so he had when I was born. He had his own Saturday night television show.
Did he? Yeah.
So it was like Russ Abbott. By date, and then like my dad had a show called And There's More, and he had it for 4 years, four series, and then he was like doing spots on variety shows and all sorts of stuff. So yeah, but when I got to probably when I was about 10, he sort of was doing less and less telly.
Was it never an issue? Was it ever an issue for you? I don't mean like you had an issue with it, but I mean like was there ever any targeting because you were celebrities, kid, or anything like that?
Do you know what? Well, I think it was like because by the time I got to high school, he wasn't really on the telly that much anymore. Like he did the odd thing. He was still doing loads of theatre and like pantos and stuff. But yeah, I think in a good way, I didn't really get shit for it. Like some people would say like, oh, your dad's not funny, or like a couple of mates would come round. And my dad's the type of, he's gorgeous, but he will do a show for everyone. So like I'd have a couple of mates around and he'd start like, singing songs to them and doing his act to them.
Right.
And I'd be like, oh, as a teenager, you'd be like, oh, thanks, Dad. Like, and he'd just like, right. I'm going home to the place tonight. I've written this new song. Who wants to hear it? And we were like, okay. And then they'd all go to school and like tell the other people that like, Katie's dad was really embarrassing.
Right.
I sort of was, but at the same time, I sort of respected that he didn't give a fuck.
Yeah.
What made, so did he put, like, did you ever, what made you want to do it then?
I didn't want to do it at all. I just, no, like, was not.
So he was a neglectful father, which is always nice to know on this podcast, isn't it? We like that. Daddy issues. Because we've got a thing like daddy issues.
I'm like, don't have, no, I really
don't. There's daddy issues. It's a running theme in our pod.
I don't.
Me and Wozniak both have it.
Yeah.
I don't feel like I have daddy issues. Right. I feel like when I was a teenager, I probably was a bit resentful of, because, you know, I was gigging all the time. And yeah. My mum would drive it because my mum was worried he would crash. He was, right. So she'd go with him. So like I had three older siblings.
Crash,
like,
because he was a bit off his head, or crash because he looked a little off.
Teetotal. Oh. That's been forever.
Yeah. Well, why was she so concerned with
him? Oh, because of like tiredness. She'd, right. Apparently some famous comedian crashed his car on the way back from a gig and that triggered her.
Right.
And then my brother.
She's more worrier then, is she?
Yeah, a little bit. My brother was his stage manager at one point. My brother didn't go to school, Frank. So he became his stage manager, and then he became a comedian. So he used to do the Frog and Bucket when it first started in like the early 90s.
So your brother's a stand-up?
No, he's a priest now.
When did he turn to the cloth?
When he was late 20s. So he did comedy for a bit. And he used to like, because he used to like Dave Gorman and Peter Kay, because he used to do the Frog with them, the little Frog. Not the Frog where it is now, but the one across the road. And then he stopped because he was like, I'm going to be a priest. But then the priesthood went, mate, you're like 21, go away.
Yeah.
Go like, do some shagging first. Years.
I don't think they put it like that. But they were like,
did they really say that?
They were like, they actually said you need more life experience and like go back to school as well, because he didn't get any GCSEs or anything because he was too busy being stage manager for my dad.
Is he a Catholic priest?
Yeah.
I always thought Catholic priests would be the other way. They want you as soon as possible.
Yeah.
No, I think they just were like, you're a bit, yeah, you don't have enough life experience. So then he went back to doing stand-up.
Right.
And he was doing that when I worked, because I worked behind the bar of the Comedy Store, which is how I got into doing comedy. And he was around the circuit doing open spots.
So
at that
both
time.
Kids did it? That's smart.
Well, I've got a brother and a sister, another brother and a sister.
And did they never have any?
My sister went to drama school, but she ended up going to teaching. And then my other brother was my dad's agent for about 20 years.
Dad's agent.
He was my dad's agent.
It's a proper little family business, wasn't it, Jimmy Cricket?
Yeah. Little sick.
This guy's not still touring, you opening your brother in the middle, your dad closing.
The fucking mulgers, gangsters around the circuit. Right.
The mulgers one night, and who's, I'm so shit with names. Who's the hospital radio? Ivan Brackenbury.
Oh, yeah.
Coming the next night, doing every spot.
While the rest
of comedians like that, fucking scabs, mate. Scabs, I'm telling you.
My dad drove me. No, sorry, my dad came
mad.
In.
Mad. Sorry.
Yeah, he did. Good, that.
Cheers.
Very good.
Thank you.
Keep it going.
I will do.
Maybe, yeah.
Mince pie.
Can I have a mince pie?
Yeah, sure.
Of course you can. I'll have one as well, actually, was. James, come on, carry on your story.
Sorry, because it was a similar thing, because I got very nervous when I got for my first car driving to gigs.
Yeah.
And he accompanied me to Shrewsbury. We were on the same gig time. Do you remember, it was for like the Freshers? And I was emceeing it. It was like me, you, that pub, the old post office or something like that in Shrewsbury.
Yes.
Yeah. It was about 4 or 5 years. No, 2019.
Yeah, I remember that one. My dad, who was on?
Me, you. I think, hey, Leon, this might have been on.
Right, okay.
And I...
Sounds like this could have been a car share.
At that point, I literally got my car yesterday, and I was like, I've got a gig in Shrewsbury. We did a trial run to Shrewsbury the day before with my dad in the car. So I was that scared. And there was apparently like a warning of flooding.
Mm.
Came with me to the gig. Went, oh, do you want to come upstairs and watch the gig? Nope. I'll just stay in the bar. He stayed in the bar all night on his phone. Yeah, and then drove him home.
Exactly.
I was like, oh, but you know, my mate Simon's on. They're good. You know, hey, it's a really good build. Do you want? Nope. Yeah. Stay in the bar.
Right, thanks. Cheers.
On my phone.
It's just not his bag. You got to respect that.
I respect that.
It's just not for him.
My dad did that to me, you know, as well.
Really?
My dad come to a gig of mine, while the proper professional Friday or Saturday night. He'd been out with his mates on the ale and just decided they were going to come to my gig. know, one of them, like, oh, your Robert's doing, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, all right, we'll go. So he come, but my dad is also, my dad's the epitome of a toxic male. So didn't want to go in the theatre because they make you sit down. And if you sit down, you're a puff. Don't sit down in a pub. Has to stand the bar.
I have to agree with that.
Yeah, has to stand up.
Yeah. It's mad that though. Where do you even get that shit?
I don't know.
There's loads of that in bars.
Like, that's mental.
Just like...
Are you serious?
Yeah.
It's just like a pandemic.
Men,
he used to be, but yeah. Don't sit down, stand the bar.
How does he drive?
No, I don't think... I think just when you're out drinking, I don't think it's constant. Like, he doesn't stand and watch the telly in the house.
Sit down shows weakness.
Yeah. Like, you've got to be standing at the bar or standing up in the pub. Like, so when COVID come in, and you know you could only sit down for a while, they refused to go to the pub. So the landlord went and bought 5 foot tables and put stools around them, and they all took the stools in and stood around the tables because they weren't allowed to stand at the bar, but they were refused to sit down.
It's such a weird hill to die on.
It is, yeah.
Sitting.
You know? But that's...
I will not sit down.
Exactly. Yeah. I don't know, because sitting leads to a cock up your arse. I know what that's all about.
So
sitting
weird.
Leads to squatting, and squatting leads to squatting on something else. So no, I know where it goes. You won't get me down that road.
Is that what pushed you into stand-up? Because you had to literally stand up. You weren't allowed to sit down.
Yeah, yeah. So anyway, because he doesn't like sitting down, his mates go in the theatre, get their seats. Then he stands at the bar and decides he's not going to go into the theatre because he doesn't want to sit down. So I'm on stage, his mates come and watch me, and he stands in the bar the whole time.
No, but my theory on that story there is the fact that he didn't want to risk seeing his son be shit in front of his mates, and that's embarrassing for him.
So he made it as an excuse.
Yeah, that's what if I had someone go, your kid's going to do stand-up now, I'd be like, oh, fuck, if he's not funny, I can't look at him. I'd be like, I'd be mortified. So I'd rather
I'd have to go home.
Yeah. I can't. Have my kid die on his arse in front of me mates who are going to go, your kid's shit at this. And he'd be like, oh, well, I didn't see it. It didn't happen.
That's happened to me twice. My parents don't come now. When I first started out, they came to watch me twice. The first one was So You Think You're Funny, Heat, 6 gigs in. Great idea. in Liverpool, dad on my arse. Oh, but you know, you did us proud. Fake. Second time was in Stoke.
The day after
Brexit, so they were all very in that area. They were particularly proud of the results.
They didn't want
first-hand whimsical embarrassment. They wanted their country back. So.
You didn't agree with your death to the West stuff then, though?
No. And did
hard hitting whimsy. Yeah.
Have you got anything Axis based? Emperor Hirohito, his philosophy was good. And then this couple were like, he's shit, isn't he? And my mum went, it's my fucking son.
And he went,
you should probably have a word with him.
Oh.
And then the car was, and as I wrote in my notepad, I was like, you stupid fucking, you're never going to be anything. I just wrote it in my notepad.
Really?
They don't come and watch me now. Oh, say for one time when my grandparents flew all the way over from New Zealand to watch me down my ass for 20 minutes at the Fringe. But other than that.
Fucking hell.
Oh, Jay.
Send them a clip for fuck's sake.
It's too much of a risk to have people that you know watch.
It's just, I don't, yeah. Even when my girlfriend comes, I feel like just no. Yeah. The green room alone is just no.
I never invite anyone, and I never have. And it always makes me, I always think it's so weird when really new acts are brought like everyone they've ever met, like all their work colleagues. Yeah. Or all of the family, and I can't cope with it because I just think, guys, you're not gonna.
I made that mistake early on.
But is it just because you think, well, there'll be people to laugh then? Is it
like idiot?
I think you assume you're decent at it because you've done all right at a couple of gigs, and then it's because I think what happened is you haven't died properly yet, so you think you're all right at it, and then death comes when
death comes when you least expect.
Yeah. I died on my hole in front of my best friend. Like 3 times quite early.
Oh, that's brutal.
Not early on.
Three deaths and one move.
But it was really spaced out as well. It just came quite early on. And I thought, all right, well, it's like a nice theatre gig, so it'll be fine. Yeah. And it wasn't even like, I could have dealt with like heckling. It was just silence. It was like you could hear my footsteps.
They're the ones that make you, though. Oh, I love that.
they could hear the crunch of my foot.
Oh, lovely.
And then I think she came again, and it was like, it was sort of a death, but it was just eggy and awkward. And I ended up just banning her because I was like, I have not died. And I think the last time she came, I was like, I haven't died, mate, for about 4 years. So you need to just fuck off and leave me alone. And I finally broke the curse when we did I did End of the Road Festival, and I was just shitted. I was so drunk. Oh. And went on stage and just like, told loads of stories about her.
Right.
And then, but like, she was delighted. She's like, you're not shit, mate. She was like, I'm genuinely so delighted. She's like, I'm so pleased you're not shit at this. Yeah.
I never invite anyone. My mates, when I go to London, I'll stay with them and then they'll book on. But I'll never make a deal of bringing someone or not.
I don't
anymore. Because I think if you don't make a deal of it, then when they turn up, it's like, well, whatever.
I get asked all the time now, but I don't invite anybody. Because it's a job now, isn't it? So it's like, I don't have to see you do your work.
I also feel
more than the job, it's fucking torture.
If you're
fucking, it's self-harm now. It's gone past being a job.
Yeah, it is. I know what you mean.
If you're working a job,
like a vocation. Yeah.
You just feel like, what? Remember Vince Atta was on you saying, Vince Atta was going like, I can't do this. Like, and then I was saying, it's funny because you're sitting there going, I don't want to do this. The guy who books it goes, I don't need you to do this. The audience don't need you there anyway. They're not there for you. So it's like, hang on, what's going to happen now is the guy's going to go on stage and do something he really fucking, really doesn't want to do right now to people that couldn't give a shit whether he was doing it or not. And it's just like, what's going on? It's like, this is meant to be this great thing and no one there is asked.
Nobody like, wants I hate to it. Be here.
You're not asked. There's somebody better who they could probably book anyway. Like, what the fuck's going on? It's like out of spite, isn't it? Like, I'm here out of spite.
When you put it like that, it really sounds quite inspirational. Yeah. There'll be people sat at home listening to this going, I'm going to be a comedian.
Yeah.
Go on, I feel like if you're working in a job, though, you're doing your utmost best to not tell people that's what you're doing in your evenings. Because, like, if you've brought a whole office with you and be like, I'm doing a gong show on a Monday and down your arse, that's the whole week. Like, if you did it on a Friday, you'd be like, oh, at least the weekend's blown over. It's probably, you know, I'm a little joke on a Monday. Fucking, like, I don't tell anyone.
I've never had colleagues since I've done stand-up, so I've never got that. But, like, there's friends of friends I'll never see again. Or if we ever see them, a shudder.
They want you to die as well, though. Exactly. Surely they want you to die.
No, I can't cope with people dying. Like, it really upsets me.
No, but your mates want to go, come on, this might be really horrible.
Women are different, aren't they? But
it's a car crash, isn't it?
I used to, when I worked at the comedy store, I used to join my like nom 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 delicious drugs phase. So I would like go out on a Saturday and then I wouldn't sleep and I'd come in for my shift on a Sunday, and the manager Jake at the time knew it. He was like, all right, come down, Queen. And he would make me do the sign at the front, which is, you know, the cinema signs with the tiny little letters. And he'd make me do the lineup for the whole next week with everyone's individual names with the tiny letters. And I hadn't slept and I was still like a bit high. And it would take me about 2.5 hours. And I'd be like, Jake, somebody else could do this in like half an hour. He's like, no, you do it. Don't worry, take your time, babe. And then he'd always make me do King Kong downstairs because it never used to be in the main when I worked there, which was a million years ago. So, how long ago? 17 years, maybe. Oh, comedy wasn't on telly or anything. So, like, it was never full, the auditorium. Every show was always in the bar downstairs.
Yeah.
So King, especially the Sunday shows, they'd set it up. And it was a lovely space for comedy, that bar downstairs. It was amazing. Yeah. So they set up the chairs and he would always make me do King Kong because he knew that I couldn't cope with people dying. Like, it makes my skin, I wasn't going to peel my skin off. Right. And so he would make me go, he'd be like, okay, you should go. Can I work upstairs tonight? No. You're on a cook down. Go and watch people die at home.
King Kong dying. It's different to a pro act dying, isn't it? Because King Dong's like, this is exactly what everyone is here for, is to see this horror show.
But
seeing a pro die.
Like, I know, I like seeing a pro die. I can't bear to see new comedians die.
The best death I ever saw, I can't remember, what was he called? He was like a London comic, and it was at Excess, the old bar Excess, and it was the most glorious death I've ever seen because it was so surreal. He did like 20, he went over as well. He did 20 minutes, like 25.
Respect that. Right,
25. Down, I'm from London, fuck this gig.
It was just to silence though.
Fuck
like, not because they're so polite and lovely there. It was and he was just doing it as if there was laughs. And I was just sort of like at the back, fascinated. It's like, is this, will he come off and think that this has been good?
Yeah.
Like, I don't, this is amazing. This is almost magical. Yeah. That he.
It's the beauty of comedy is the element of the death.
Trevor.
Smell of death.
Is it Trevor Locke?
I recognise that name. He's a proper comic.
He's from Mankiny.
Oh, I don't know. All I know is that I got him confused with another comedian. Yeah. And I was telling everyone that it was like the worst death I'd ever seen. And then I met the other comedian. I was like, oh, fuck, you're not Trevor Locke.
I think Trevor Locke.
And he was like, why? I was like, because I've been telling everyone that like you had like the most spectacular, most brilliant death I've ever seen. Oh. And he was like, oh, brilliant. It's probably why I've never been booked in Manchester.
I hate dying in there if like your mates are on and they all have a good one and you're like,
proper misery.
I did a gig like, I really like Mark Nelson, and he saw me. I did like a good gig in front of him, and he saw me. He's like, "Oh, mate, that was good. Oh, cheers." Having a chat with him, I was like, "I can't believe it. I'm having a chat. This is great." Booked with him again, like a few months later. Fucking died on my arm. Like while he came in at the pint, he was like, "Oh, I'll go and watch James
Nelson loves watching the death. He saw mine.
Stunk the place out." And I was like, "I was going to Mark. Just really sorry about that." Just like, he's like, "Oh no, mate. Yeah, I know you're saying it's fine, but I know what that feeling is like. So please just, you know, in your head, just remove that. If we could just forget whatever happened in the past 20 minutes, you could just remember, you know, the time you met me beforehand, which was 6 months ago. If you keep that memory in your head, that'd be great. Because that was the, please, Mark, don't follow me on Twitter. Like that. Like, on the drive home, just like, oh. And then he tweeted me after the game, went, "We'll all remember what happened there, mate." And I was like, oh.
That's how you know it's nice.
Yeah, it was nice. He was lovely. He was really nice about it. But I hate dying in front of
him. Nobody meant it, though.
Oh, like, it's awful. It's horrible. Yeah. My worst death I've ever had was at Excess when I was in Open Spot. And it was when everybody used to go to Excess as a social, like all the Manchester comics used to go. Like every Tuesday, everybody went. It was when I first started. So and Excess is so nice. It was really nice back then. And the room was lovely that I died for 10 minutes. I remember coming off stage and walking into like a Mick Ferry, Jason Cook, Dan Nightingale. And they're all like, and I went, it's fine. Don't need to make eye contact with me. Nobody talk to me. We all know what's happened. Yeah. I'm going to go have a glass of wine and then we're all going to move on.
Yeah.
I don't need anyone to discuss this.
It is weird what you do after you die. And like, how do you go? I think you're just going to go, fucking died then. And then just, because then people are going to be thinking, oh, you're going to be in the depths of despair, which you probably are going to be a bit.
I am on the driver. Like, I get angry, annoyed, and then I get pissed that night.
Yeah.
On the old whiskey. Get myself into a stupor, then I wake up the next day and I'm fine.
If the audience are genuine assholes, or the people that are running the gig are putting a gig somewhere where it shouldn't be, and it's a terrible gig, like, then I'm like, that, I genuinely get in the car and go, that wasn't me. I'm all right with it. I can make peace with that. I'm like, that wasn't me. But when I'm like, sometimes if I've had a death, I will overthink it and be like, well, I could have said this then, or I should have said that when that happened. Or
I'm like that every time. Like, oh, well, I've approached it a bit different. Well, I've approached, was too harsh there.
It's just get the thought that you never work again, innit? Like, everyone's going to hear about this. That's it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes.
But you know what? No one cares.
Layers.
No one gives
a shit.
I felt like I've got, like, when I first saw that, I drafted Facebook statuses being like, so everyone knew I gigged with last night at, I don't know, the Hooting Owl. Wasn't at my best. Please don't think anything of it. I'm going to bounce back. And I felt like I had to do this massive, like, big apology. Like,
to the rest of the industry, whatever you hear, just know it's exaggerated, okay?
I love...
You hear
I
that,
love,
PBJ?
I love people that die, though.
I love
it's people. Like, we all love people that can die. I think they're the best, aren't they? Like, they go like, this can go bad. Like, we've seen what he does. Yeah. This can... There's a good chance this isn't going to go great.
I love acts that... Like, are either there's no in between. It's they will smash the roof. Like, I'll see them absolutely smash the roof off it, or it's so awkward. Yeah. You want to die.
Yeah, that's a good thing, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, it also means you're doing something that nobody else is doing, because if they get you.
Just the idea that he can just fuck himself in at any second. He can fuck this because he's so sketchy and so fucking. I like that edge to it. Yeah. I go, like, this might not go well, you know. I just think that's a nice thing to be.
I can't have that, though, me. I couldn't do that. I couldn't live like that. No one at any gig could go badly.
On the edge.
Like, I understand some of them can go badly, but no one at any point a gig... Oh, no.
There was a guy in the 90s whose that whole act was just chainsawing blocks of ice in half. And then he'd...
That's not the guy that used to put a rocket up his bum.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh yeah, he's still gigging.
Really?
Is he? God.
Oh God.
He used to like finish
that's
the
too
act,
much.
Like,
yeah. That's too much work.
Stop and putting a.
That's too much work.
There was a guy as well who came on with like records, and he'd be like, I don't know, Lionel Richie, and hey, and then they would go boo.
Lionel Richie,
and then he just and then he just smash it, and they'd be like, right, Kate Bush, boo, and then he'd just do that.
I love that shit.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. I genuinely. It also gives me a bit of hope.
When I watch it though, I just think that's too much hassle. Yeah. Too much. I remember when I started, I used to headbutt the mic at one point, and then I stopped because I couldn't be arsed anymore.
My dad has been doing his act for 50 years, and he takes a big fuck off suitcase, suitcase full of props to every gig he's ever done.
Tell him to get some. Ugh.
That's do a some new bits. Level of.
And also, like when he did like some of the variety shows, he would do sketches, so we'd have like. The props in storage. He used to have these massive giant sombreros in storage so I can fit a person in them.
Why has he given himself so much work?
That's my favourite sketch that he's ever done. It's so stupid. He just comes out in like a Mexican outfit with a hat and with maracas and sings and shouts peanuts. And then he goes off stage in a bigger hat saying peanut comes back. And then the tag is just, he's just in a giant hat with like windows. So stupid. But we had that in like our loft at one point.
I know, it's your
spot. I was like, what? Like when we had a big house before he stopped being on telly and we had to move.
Oh no.
Yeah, of course.
Well, no, and obviously the daring to go down, but I didn't have to secure the house.
Four children.
Oh, he didn't secure the house, he just thought bought a big house.
We had a daft like Well they're both like my mum's a working class Belfast, like one of eight. He's like one of seven. Again, working guys. So they basically, like, as soon as they came back, they were like, we're going to build a massive house.
Right.
And we're going to do everything we can for our children because we all both left school at 14.
Yeah. Understand that, though. But you got to secure the house, haven't you? That's what my always think. If I ever make a bit of money, about the house is getting paid in cash because that's going nowhere. Like, at least if we're going to be poor, we're going to be poor in a big house.
Well, I also didn't realise how, like, privileged I was because I remember, like, my husband, when we first started going out, and he, like, came to the house, and this was the one that we'd moved to for, like, dinner, and I was like, yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it's quite small. He, like, rolled up, and he was like, mate, this is massive, like, what are you on about? I was like, oh, okay. I was like, sort of like, check your privilege, babe. But I was like, oh, okay. All right, fine, yeah. Like all these things that you just assume. Like, yeah.
Yeah.
But no, we had to move. And we also, like, all the lessons stopped. Like, piano lessons. Everything stopped. It was like, why have all the music lessons stopped?
What age were you when this happened?
It's about 13.
Oh, so you really were settled into your comforts, weren't you? And then they all just got taken away.
Well, no, I mean, that's
fucking
not for you, is it? It's like...
Was there a smorgan here?
You know what? That's what he's like.
What?
I had a lovely...
Do you reckon your half fella, was it a sudden change with him? Or could he just see it depreciating and just lie to himself or what?
No, I think...
Or was he just like hopefully it'll come back up sort of thing?
No, I think it was more just like he didn't want to do a lot of stuff he got offered. I mean, he's been offered he's been offered like all the stuff like I'm a Celebrity and like Marigold Hotel and all that. I mean, he just doesn't want to do it. He's got like a real strong
selfish bastard.
Well, he's got like a real morality about his character. Right. It's like this innocence of this. So like he's been offered acting work and stuff, and he wouldn't take it. Or like he's been offered he was offered game shows when he first like his telly show
to present.
Yeah, and he just didn't want to do it because he said it ruins his character.
Would he ever step away from the character and just do it himself? No.
No, because it's who he is. It's like, I think it's hard to separate when you do that. Like, I bet Johnny Vegas is similar. Like, when you've got, it's hard to then.
Well, he's had to, and he sort of.
He would have died.
His book came out, and then he sort of separated Danny a little
bit. Yeah, like, my dad's character isn't like a raging alcoholic. Mine's it's like a slightly daft Irish man.
Did you ever do a game show?
Present one?
Yeah, like, if you got.
The money's right, yeah. Fuck it. Yeah. I'll sit there and read out.
Is it A or B?
Give a fuck.
Spin the fucking wheel.
I love the wheel. I love the wheel.
Yeah,
I'm really into the wheel.
Is it the Michael McIntyre one?
The wheel.
That one.
The wheel. My son loves it.
I only watched Tea
Time
ones.
He's obsessed with it.
I don't know. Would I do it? I mean, I'm never going to get offered it. But yeah, again, if the money, you got to do it, haven't
Which
you?
Which one? Which one would you do?
I'd like, if it was came back, I'd like to do Wheel of Fortune.
Really?
Yeah.
Why Wheel of Fortune?
I love that game. Oh, Catchphrase.
I'd love to. Yeah,
Catchphrase, and then Wheel of Fortune. Then me too.
I like Catchphrase. You can be a bit nasty to them, Catchphrase. I've noticed.
Yeah, you can be a bit snide, can't you?
Fucking idiot. The fuck was that? Slow the snide. I go. What do you get? We've never heard that in the life.
We've removed one of these nine squares. You can barely see what it is. It's just a hovering object. You've gone with X.
Yeah.
You swats.
Catchphrase, yeah.
Mullern, something about Mullern.
I love Catchphrase.
I love
it's
it.
Great,
it?
Well.
Oh, it was I quite like a family thing. Oh, yeah. Like my son will put it on like ITV player. Like, what do you want to watch, mate? Oh. And he'd be like, Pete the Chasers or Catchphrase. Like, he's seven.
That's nice. My wife won't watch game shows with me.
Why?
Because I'm too competitive.
Oh, yes.
Because
I'm toxically competitive.
I love the...
Really?
Yeah, yeah. I really, really am. Like, so, like, she stopped.
You have to be stood up while you do it.
I
at the telly.
I have my hand over her mouth because she shouts too early. And it ruined, like, no, it's the rules. You'd be out now if we were playing this game. So.
Oh, my God, that's the rule.
So, like... And now I can't concentrate because you're shouting shit out before the question's been asked.
So you can't play, you don't play board games or anything then?
We try to.
That.
But quite
not
often.
Not even Uno.
I love. Well,
Uno's boss.
No, but this is the other thing with me, Katie. I am an expert cheat. So
you
I cheat at everything.
You're only cheating yourself, babe.
I cheat at Uno, yeah. No, I'm not cheating myself on a win, though, am I?
Yeah, but you don't win in the... It's like having a conversation with myself with you, and it's like, yeah, but you don't win for the right reasons. It's not winning if you don't win properly.
Are you the type of guy who, when there's a Christmas cracker presented on a table,
you grip
the main body of the cracker?
You know, a little crease?
Yeah.
So you have your hand, you have your fingers like that on the handle, and you have your thumb. In the crease.
You've got a grip for like
everything. I've got a grip for Uno.
So
what you like to do, obviously everyone's got the six on nines, that's easy stuff. Sometimes what I like to do is I purposely get caught cheating. It's my favourite thing because no one expects you to cheat again straight away. So I'll do a nice little blatant six on a nine and they'll be like, you can't do that, that's not a nine, you're trying to put a six. I go, oh, fucking hell. So I'll pick up Demia. The next thing I'll just put four cards down. No one's looking what you're doing because you've just been caught cheating. He's not going to cheat again so blatantly.
I feel really sad, Rob. I feel sad that you've let yourself down.
I haven't. I've
never played Uno.
56-0, mate. So.
Mate, you've got Christmas coming up. Treat yourself.
You never played Uno.
It's good, you know.
Uno's boss.
I'd love it.
I've got very into Scrabble.
Do a live stream Uno.
No.
Do a Patreon Uno special.
We've done a Patreon Monopoly special.
Have you?
Yeah.
Who won?
What did you think one?
It didn't end.
It ended because I dominated too much.
Were you like drinking at the same time?
Yeah, we all getting bladdered.
Says that, and then I fucking spanked him.
I turned to the camera and said, "Give us a check. Give us in the comments. Give us some timestamps if you can see when I've cheated."
Was it a live stream?
No. I just said give us some like a timestamp if you can catch me cheating.
Phil Ellis's hand with you was one of the best moments of this podcast.
Yeah, and then we done a poker one. It was the first one we done.
Yeah.
And obviously you can't really cheat a poker because it's for money. People are much more hyper aware.
I don't understand poker.
Neither does Phil, and he beat him.
I love the asp. I love everything about it. I love the atmosphere.
Poker.
I love poker. I love, but when it comes to receiving the cards, I don't know what I'm doing. I love the camaraderie.
Going to a poker night?
Yeah, like I think, like I like the idea of being like, hey, I'm like Danny Ocean.
Yeah,
but in reality,
problem
Billy
is, like,
River.
I feel like you'd turn up dressed like that as well.
I would, yeah. I did James Martin.
Sometimes you bring it on yourself.
For my birthday, we're going to James Martin's casino in Manchester, and we look like Rain Man coming down the escalator. My flight boy, send me your flight boy. I was there like, and she was like my guardian. Went to a table on my own playing blackjack. She was stood behind me. And I went,
you dressed up?
I had like a cool, like a cool.
Cool.
I had a floral shirt on.
Like, cool shirt, like James. It's cool.
Couples. Yeah. Outlet. Cheshire Oaks Outlet.
Couples, though?
I wasn't buying it from.
Hey, you've got to be a slim man to wear a couple.
Oh, it always.
Slim man.
There's a bit of.
He is a slim man, but that's what I mean. You've got to be like,
yeah,
so slim. Oh, it's
purposely, like, you know how Kim Kardashian
we
worked.
Wear quadruples.
Like Kim Kardashian worked her ass off to get into Marilyn Monroe's.
Yeah,
that was like me with this, and I've not worn it. And I've not worn it.
What was she wearing? Gown and that.
She had a dress on, but what? No, not like, you know, no velvet gloves or like plastic. Not one that
you
picked out. That.
You didn't make her wear one, did
you?
No. I picked this for you.
Wear it.
I was thinking sometimes you look really overdressed. I think people assume that you're not old enough to get in somewhere. Is this what you think adults dress like?
Yeah, yeah.
Hello, mate.
Did you win?
Did he have to tell you the etiquette?
Yeah, so I went with, like, money.
Did you go twist? And he was like, no, it's him.
Yeah. Well, I went, it's been, like, all cool, like, and he went, huh? And I went,
finger tap.
And he went, yeah, you knock on the table a bit aggressively there. Just say.
Just a little flick of the hand.
Just a double tap.
Yeah. A little swipe for, that's me done.
Oh, I love it.
Just double tap, hit me.
Really?
Leave it alone.
Oh, it's like Apple. Like,
you sit there and just lose thousands, Katie, just in silence.
Because I'm just like, I'm sorry, what am I doing?
Just
like a baseball.
Like doing the cool song thing. I got two tickets to the lobby. To buy a whiskey for
the nine, please. A nine.
I did spend a day learning the Cub song once.
Did you?
And it was, I remember being my husband going home and going, and I was like, look. And I showed him and he went, put up the day writing comedy then.
Yeah. he missed me when I went because I rinsed me for like 50 quid.
He rinsed you for 50 quid?
Well, he said, he handed me the cards and I went to pick them up and he went, whoa.
You can't pick them up.
Don't touch the cards. And I was like,
Why would you pick them up?
The illusion was shattered. Like, it went from being in this, like, to being in, like...
Right, you've been told off,
Manchester. Yeah. It was like, and you know that feeling you get when you get told off and you get really
Mr.
hot?
Mr. Robinson.
Yeah.
I get really hot when I get told, like, I'm under pressure. Right. And I was like, I can't... And I was sending to be like Dustin Hoffman off Rayman. I was like,
go home, stay with Charlie Bevitt.
No, I didn't mean to tap there. No.
Did you even order a drink?
Yeah. He's like, sip your IPA. Sip your Goose Island.
I'd have thought you'd have gone for like a martini upstairs. And be like, oh no.
Well, I wanted my idea was.
Yeah, whiskey. Like,
yeah, that was.
Spill a bit on a show.
Yeah. Oh, it tastes nice, that. Let it settle.
Lovely.
Teaspoon of water in that. Take the edge off.
You're not gambling big enough when you're getting shouted by the dealer because you can just be so angry at them.
I just kept going.
Just
leave. It's because he knows you're not tipping.
Yeah.
Would you place a minimum bet as well?
Yeah, the minimum bet was like 20 quid.
Oh, it's a good table, that.
And but then table. I went on a bit of a hot streak of like 5 or 6 in a row. And he went, just let you know you are like
up
100 quid up here. And I went,
leggy.
I took the Bobby T philosophy.
What's that?
Keep going.
Oh. What is it? Eat the chips.
It's not my philosophy. Oh, sorry, but like, in a casino, but I profit all the time.
Keep.
My philosophy is to go till everything's gone and more. Yeah,
bit of a, like I say, whenever I come on, you're like my yin and yang, you know.
Yeah.
Keep hoping.
Gambling. Like on The Simpsons.
To be like your conscience.
Gambling. Yeah.
Devil.
Keep. Gaming.
Hope. When the fun stops, carry on.
When like the fun stops, good. You're like, it was never meant to be fun.
Another 400, please, madam.
You're like...
here's how samey I am. You know what I'm saying about my reels? I have the same 10 numbers on roulette as well.
Oh, I do that with the lottery, just in case.
Yeah. The only time I've ever been in a casino is when I ran out of places to carry on drinking.
Yeah.
Which is normally London. So it's always that casino in
the Hippodrome.
The Hippodrome. It's always there because weirdly London
closed.
Unless
you're
like a member. Yeah. So the amount of times I would end up there until about 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. Yeah.
I used to have rich mates in uni and we used to go all the time. And like just like spending the dad's money. They were talking about the time when we got paid to leave. I got a mate who's like he loved the casinos, so I used to just go with him, and he'd give me like 20 quid to gamble with, and then he'd gamble like 800 quid out of his dad's account, and we were playing 21, and his netiquette had like been on the end boxes, and if you're on the end boxes, you're meant to play for the table. Because there's certain things in 21, like you don't do. If the dealer's got a 6, you don't take a card. because he's more than likely going to go bust. So no one takes a card, so there's more tens in the pack, so the ego's bust. But my mate wasn't caring about the etiquette. He was just playing for himself. So, like, there's a fella here with four boxes, £200 a box, and my mate's paying 25s or something like that, and he keeps taking them sixes or fives, and at the end, and, like, pulling a 10 out, and the next thing could be a 3, and then another 10, and it'd be 19, the dealer's won. And this fella got so sick of it, just turned to me and went, "How much are you wanting to win tonight?" And he was like, "What?" And he was like, "How much are you hoping to go home with tonight? Like, what is going to make you go home? What are you going to make you happy to go home with?" And he's like, £600. And the fella just threw 600, literally threw it at him and went, "Go."
Love that.
Go. my mate was going to say no. And I was like, "We're going. We are going.
Take it and run." Weird.
Quite a funny, except that they just want you to win. Because the idea is to, like, keep you in there for as long as possible.
No, but this was another gambler who was so sick. It wasn't the house, no. Oh, right. The house would have made up with him.
It was a guy who was so
annoyed at losing, and he kept playing me mate, because my mate was playing the M box, that he's just paid him to go away. He was like,
there used to be a compere. He used to, like, do that thing of, if there was an awful, like, heckler or someone shitty in the audience, like a drunk person was like, yeah, "I'll give you £20 to go, like, to a bar next door, or go into, like, the main bar."
Yeah,
I don't think that's a really good idea. But then sometimes there's some clubs where you're like, "I'd lose an absolute." £150 if I did that to everybody in that room that was an arsehole. I wouldn't, like, my fee for that gig would go back to the audience. Oh,
yeah.
Guys, I've just remembered there's a fuel shortage. Oh.
What did I say? £20? Sorry, I misspoke.
What did feel cool was, like, because I was a bit of a hot streak, and then Lani was like, "Stop!" Like, because I was in the shoes. No. She's like, "Shut up.
You're in the zone.
Yeah, in the zone."
Like,
yeah.
No, Simon's telling you're me you're locked in. You're like Ray Winston. You're like,
you just tapping like you're on fentanyl.
Fucking carry on, mate.
You just wanted to all be over.
Was it house deposit?
Take it all.
House deposit.
Hit me. Hit me. Yeah. I want to feel something.
House deposit. Temporary, mate.
Yeah.
You know, it isn't permanent. Serotonin.
Yeah.
And carrying the chips and stuff. So, like, when I withdrew, and I mean, I only had like that. But even carrying them, I was like,
Yeah, but did you do that? Even though it was tiny.
Yeah, even though it was tiny, I went. Load of coasters.
Oh, so you left up.
But yeah.
Did you tip the dealer before you left?
I did, yes. Yeah. I said thanks very much. And he's like, "Yeah, it's been. It's happened." Oh. And then went on the slots.
Oh.
Yeah.
Do you know what is delicious? Like, Remy fentanyl. You can have that when you give birth.
What?
Remy fentanyl is fentanyl, but it's when you give it birth. But they don't really advertise it. Because, I mean, yeah. So my mate's obstetrician was like, "Katie, get next time you have a baby," because I didn't have any drugs for the first one and I absolutely regretted it with every fibre of my being. So the second time she was like, "Katie, get Remy fentanyl." And I said, "Well, what's that?" And it's where they put a drip in, and they give you a button, and when you feel a contraction coming on, you press the button and it floods you full of fentanyl.
Yeah.
Right. It's great.
Oh, wow.
Is it?
Except there's nothing worse though than because my kid was £9.12.
Right.
So then, like, after, and I pushed him out. So afterwards, when he was stitching me up, so like your legs are like, and they're stitching you up, and they took everything out, and I was like, "Oh my god, oh yeah, no, I'm having a come down." Whilst I'm being, they are stitching me back together. I like started like shaking, and got all the oxytocin had worn off. He's like, "Are you going under?"
You didn't get high?
Oh yes, off my absolute face. Yeah.
Sounds amazing.
So at one point, I was like, "As I'm ruined," to the midwife, she went, "Oh, do you mean like off your face?" I was like, "No, physically." I'm physically ruined.
It's fucking heavy, though, fentanyl, isn't it?
I'd love that.
I also double dropped as well, because I was like, it's not enough, so they put it in both arms.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my goodness.
They're not monitoring you, like, she's like,
Well, yeah, it's just like every time. Yeah, and then they take it out straight away. But yeah, it's To be fair, it doesn't really help because you still have the horrific pain of the contraction. It's just afterwards you feel so good. It feels like you've been rewarded for the pain. So like, so whilst it's happening, you're like, oh, this is the fucking worst thing. That's right.
You had no drugs at all for the first.
Abby was the first one.
He was 9'6".
Fucking hell, both big ones.
But they had to pull him out.
Oh, I was
couldn't
yeah.
push him out. Like he had to. Oh no, honestly, forceps. They tried everything. They had to get forceps in the end. He just would not. And he was 2 weeks late. I was just like, fuck off, mate.
Selfish prick.
Nothing at all.
You had the opposite of mine. Mine was 8 weeks early.
Not having it. Not having it, mate.
Too keen.
So they have to give you something.
Well, like paracetamol. But the thing is, I did ask for it because I was all like, oh, right.
I want to do natural.
Well, not that. I just was like, right, I'll have what I can until I can't take it anymore. And then I'll have the next thing. Because I thought, I don't know how long this is.
Oh, but it goes to, you so can I'll go like, past do it the in stages.
It, yeah. And then it got to the point where I was like, this is after I'd like vommed all over the midwife several times. And then at one point they just brought a load of students in. So I was like naked from the waist down. And I was like, had my hand, because I don't know why, but it's just any position that you could attempt to not feel pain. I was like stood on the bed, like that.
Like bent over.
Yeah, and then someone just went, oh, the students are all coming in, and like 30 people came in, and I was like, Lee, get like,
so where like, was Lee while you were stood on the bed?
He grabbed a sheet, like some sort of magicians. Like
30 people came in watching you give birth.
I was in the middle of giving birth, because when she said it, I was like, yeah, whatever. Just
maybe it's a technique to scare it out of you. That's what I think they sometimes mention. They go, like, we'll have to cut her open now. I was like, oh, shit.
Yeah, and then I was like, oh, can I have an epidural now? And he said, oh, well, you know, you're 8 centimetres dilated. And it's the only time I've been an absolute petulant child, because I just went, fine. Just like somebody, I was the embarrassing person, woman, when I gave birth, because I just, I did that thing that they do in one born every minute where they scream so much, it was embarrassing.
And he felt just like, for fuck's sake, a bit much.
First one was about 19 hours, and then the second one was dead quick, because it was, he'd been induced. So it was like four
92
hours.
92 minutes we were. Flew out, it was great.
2 minutes stoppage time.
Yeah. Literally what I was thinking.
Midwife putting up the...
Yeah. So we're on there, we'll see if we can...
He come out, and I was sitting thinking, I've sat for longer football matches than this. What's everyone going on about?
Your missus is probably just terrified you into a sudden. We need to get out for Mackie's breakfast. Corner, yeah. We're heading at 9, Mackie's at 11 o'clock.
It was 92 minutes, it was great. It was in and out, flying.
Yeah, mate, you shouldn't tell people that, though, because, like, it's, yeah, my mother-in-law would say that. She's like, oh, well, you know, I enjoyed giving birth.
Oh,
and it takes like everything to fire your beans. I'd be like, fuck off.
It's all right to say once you've done it, innit?
Yeah, it's because it was 8 weeks early. That's what it was. So,
right.
So you have to throw that in afterwards. You know, when you get a cabin with you, you throw that in, and everyone feels dead bad, and you're like, oh no, he's fine.
Just 6 to 7,
just dead early.
I was for me. Wasn't that hard though? No.
Just on your phone, playing for gigs.
Did you have like music? We had like.
I can't remember what the song was. No, it was a radio. We didn't have any music.
We had Brooklyn. I had Brooklyn 99 on the second time.
Right.
And you just said like it turned like you were like, oh, just fucking turn the lights around and get off.
I can imagine you going, oh, 300 quid double.
Yeah. There's holding your newborn and getting a 300 quid double, James. Especially in the cost of living thing. You're like, oh, Thursday's a Sunday one.
That's just like that going, I've got a Christmas residency.
You held them? Do you still need me?
You don't know real joy until you get every club gig in January, mate. That'd be a dream, wouldn't it? No gigs going apart from clubs. How was your lockdown COVID thing?
Well, I did my second one 2 days before COVID.
Oh, did you? How's the development?
Lockdown. Oh, it's
fine.
COVID babies are struggling sometimes, aren't
they? It's all right. I mean, he's quite violent.
All right, there you go.
So he's got a lot, like, he's quite stocky. He's quite a big lad.
Did you get jabbed whilst you're pregnant?
No. Right. Well, no, because he was 2 days before lockdown. Oh, so, like, right. I had him, so, and then fine, and then we saw the grandparents, and then we went into lockdown.
Right. Did you do the classic with the second child? You nailed the first one, so the second one's going to be a daddle as well. And the second one's an absolute nightmare.
Oh, he's, yeah. He's
That's the common theme, isn't it? Like, your first one's amazing. So you think, I'll just have a second one.
I mean, they're both quite stressful.
Oh, are they?
Yeah. Oh, I don't know. I was yanked out.
Was it?
Yeah.
Yeah, the old tweezers.
Yep. My mum was like, nope,
plucked you
that's
out
enough
there.
For me. And 25 years of
bliss.
Paving
fighting
over cracks.
People.
Yeah.
making people cry in your name.
Yeah, yeah. Going ham on teachers.
Where does that come from, that saying?
Going ham. It sounds American, doesn't it? Like, if you go
I've
ham
never heard
teacher.
That before.
Never heard of going ham?
No.
Yeah, it's a saying.
But there's, so I got it off my fella who's Derbyshire, but those people say they've never heard the expression, did you see your ass?
Oh, yeah. So
oh, yeah, I know that, yeah.
You know that one, see your ass? Yeah. Did they see your ass?
Did they see your ass? No, did you?
So, like, saw your ass?
If you kicked off, like, did
yeah,
you see
your
ass?
Your yeah, seen your ass, yeah.
Seen your ass, yeah. All right.
Well,
and heel of the bread. I think that's an Irish thing.
No, never heard heel of the bread.
Northern Irish, you know, the end of the bread, it's the heel.
Makes sense. I've never heard it.
Like seeing your ass, what would that be? Just why would that? Where would that? You know, you see your ass, you get mad. Why is it seeing your ass?
I don't know, but you ask these things, and then we're never going to find out, are we?
I mean, yeah. I know that you're. I like
137.
I would never.
Oh, is it because it's the anger that you can never? You'll never find it. That's what's making you angry.
Because it's the anger. Because
you'll spend that.
No, yeah. Don't think it'll be that. But
I thought that was a decent. Yeah.
We'll put a maybe by that one.
Let us know in the comments.
Got to try the new stuff.
Yeah.
You've got to have a good time for the new time.
James has got a gig every Tuesday.
Are we promoting that now?
No, I was just mentioning it.
I wanted to ask about the baby and child gigs before we go.
Oh, go on then.
You do baby gigs, don't you? What are they like?
I do one. I've not got a franchise or anything, so I can't your ass. I'm running one gig. I find it quite stressful.
What are they like, the gigs?
They are, they're chaos. They're not easy, but they're not hard or anything, but they're just not like any gig you'd ever do.
Who are you playing? Are you trying to make the mums or the dads
Yeah,
laugh?
So it's the parents, but they bring the babies. But the most stressful thing about it is it's just not,
no
they're just so
attention.
Noisy. Yeah. No, but it's just like, sometimes it can be quite odd. Do you know what? Simon Lomas... When he went, I've never seen anything like it. He started talking and the entire room of babies stopped.
Yeah. They know a nonce when they see you on
it. I don't think
you don't have to be able to talk to smell that one out.
It's called instinct, that Katie. Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
They all shat themselves at the same time.
He did the bit that he does about, you know, like staring at somebody and then saying, like, they started on him, but he did it to a baby.
Yeah.
And like, everybody was like, all the mums were a bit like, is he genuinely kicking off this, like, baby? But no, yeah, it's weird because obviously sometimes sometimes they'll be totally fine and then all of a sudden you'll be on stage and then it'll just one will go and then loads will go and it'll just escalate.
How old are the babies normally?
So
do you have to age cap
it? 18 months in case just because it's all adult content, you just do normal set
just but in case they can
it's also it's tricky because it's supposed to be like a safe space, so I mean they all booze, they all buy drinks.
What time is it?
It's at 1 p.m. on a Friday,
so they're all boozing at that and you can say cunt.
Oh yeah, I could see what. Yeah, but then also there's sometimes they're
I
not.
I wouldn't sit
the most...
right with me that. I don't. Even I'd be like, I can't.
Really? Can you fine?
Really?
See, with Bailey, it did nothing but filth for 20 minutes, and they loved it.
It's got something
weird about
it. Something naughty about it.
What was Rob Rouse did like this whole bit about how he wanted to have sex with Tom Hardy after watching him on CBeebs.
Anyone ever done any pedo jokes?
And like, you know what? I think one of the first ones he ever did, Alex Borman started doing a pedo joke and then halfway through he stopped himself and went, I'm so sorry.
Yeah,
I am so distracted. Like, this is so noisy. I'm just gonna definitely not do that bit.
Right.
And I'm just gonna do the next bit. Yeah. And then like, just carry, cause he was just like, I'm so, like, I just didn't know where, cause it's quite unsettling. I think it's a bit like, I can imagine it's like about like doing a corporate, you know, when everyone's talking. At a corporate,
and you
just like, I have to, just
do it, just go through it.
But it's good fun. I mean, Will Duggan just always smashes it because he basically does 20 minutes where he goes like, "What's the name of the kid?" And then like, "Okay, well they're going to be an arsehole. What's the name of that kid?"
Name.
That's going to be like he'll go around and do all the names, but they just love it.
Oh,
But no, it's good. It's, yeah, it's good fun, but it's batshit.
It sounds like my idea of hell. Like,
really?
Yeah.
I think it's a good thing to do, though. Like, something a bit...
Oh, I don't know. It just feels
wrong, doesn't it?
What was my favourite one was, I think it was me and Laurel X and Shanyaski. And I remember Shanyaski coming off stage and going, oh, it just feels really weird, like, being like the only man, like, in a room where, like, the majority of people are, like, women and, like, they were acts. I mean, Laura were like, does it feel weird, mate? Does it feel weird being singled out as, like the only man in, like, a room full of women? That's so interesting because that's basically what we feel like.
Yeah. I think it's
most
the kids.
Of the time.
Now he's had a kid, though. I bet he has changed. Now he's had a kid, yeah. He'll be like,
love it.
It's fucking great. You know, it's sound, yeah. Just doing loads of material about his kid.
No, I didn't do one.
What?
I've never done a kid's one.
No.
Oh yeah, I find a kids comedy club one's hard.
It's not,
I've got
it's
kids.
Not a kids comedy. It's for the adults.
No, it's for the adults. It's just your normal material, but the babies just happen to be there.
There's something.
Mate, if you feel weird about doing your material in front of babies, what is that saying about your material?
It's appropriate for adults.
Maybe we are too toxic. I'm just thinking, oh.
I don't know. Maybe I should go and just start swearing.
I just end up. I just think I'd end up like trying to.
I go too far, and I'd say something about doing something to one of the kids, and then be like, "Oh shit!"
You know.
I'd be like, "If we're gonna be filthy, let's be horrible."
It's also like Charlton as well, so it's like super middle class,
right? Yeah,
yeah.
But it's funny because there's always like one, at least one dad. Sometimes there's more, but there's always like at least one dad, and I'm always a bit like, "You are here with." Somebody or with a baby. You're not just like,
which one's yours? Yeah. Which one's yours?
You're just not like, you're not really into new mums. Like, oh, they're just at the most vulnerable. Like, just like gonna go and chat some new mums.
Can that happen? Can a regular punter go without a child?
Well, I don't think.
Is it a bring your own baby or not?
Yeah, that would be fucking horrible.
If they are, like, I've never noticed
it. Where'd you buy
tickets? You could just get them online. I suppose you could just like rock up, but I'm sure someone would like spot you and notice you and you'd
just
be all over mum's there.
Doll.
I'm sure someone with a phone would be like,
yeah. You just got a dog.
Yeah, what about like, you know, you're about a boy? You're like there with your dirty car. She's going, oh, he was meant to be with me, but he's gone to some party with his mum. But
so
I thought he'd be
bored
of the ticket now anyway.
Yeah,
so.
That would be mad.
I'd love to be about a boy. What if
what?
That's great. Out of you.
Would you let that man in?
Now I'm thinking, like, do we need the lovely volunteers at the city need to vet people like who's baby it with mate? Like
Well, could you take a doll and they go doll. And everyone's looking at them and they go,
it's a brand new, but it's a brand new.
Yeah, and then he's just keeping it dead tight and going, what's his name?
Oh, no. Shh, we're one of them fucking most.
I don't think anyone cares enough.
Them cloth things.
But if he's just sitting there, a little
papoosh.
GoPro in his shirt and he's just
you have a little papoosh, a little bit of real hair on top of the doll so they can only see it and you're like, and they think you're lovely because you've got the baby and the papoosh and you're like, oh.
Yeah.
Maybe this is why we can't play them because we don't have an idea like this.
The idea that some of these kids' gigs, there has been a nonce in the audience.
Why would you ruin it. Why would
that's
you go
sad with
there?
It now?
Yeah. Oh, I was.
I'm just saying, you have to be very safeguarding. We must know that
they
are all there.
Someone toxic trying to get vulnerable mums, but now you've made it.
Yeah, it was fine when it was just someone wanting to bang someone.
Now it's, the fake doll.
New mums deserve a shag as well.
Yeah, they do, yes.
Although you don't, no.
The baby's acting as wingmen for the mums.
I think that's a high percentage of times people cheat.
What?
Just after having a new baby.
Really? Apparently it's a high percentage of people splitting up.
Mostly men. Apparently that's a high percentage when people cheat just after a new kid.
Oh God, you'd have to be a particular
anger.
Piece of shit.
I was forward with my dad.
What those stats?
Shove your numbers up your
ass. Shove that up your box.
So why? Yeah, no. Well, my wife said
to be at your most fertile. That's like, I remember the helpers that come around like after 7 days and being like, okay, what contraception are you using? I was like, are you
sleep, love.
I'm not being funny,
mate.
Have you seen this? This is the contraception. I'm like, I'm on airplane mode. Like, you can get fucked at the moment.
Literally by someone else.
I think that's mad though. You know when people's kids are like 9 months apart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think I So my wife's had kids the same time as her mates, and one of them was at it almost like 2 weeks afterwards, and I was like, "Are you for fucking real?"
It's just so tired. Just no. It's just so exhausting.
I haven't got it in me.
I thought it wasn't. You weren't meant to be fertile at that point.
You're thinking of periods.
Because your hormones are all just... No, your hormones are just all so fucked and everything that...
No, I think you are most fertile after a child, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well, obviously, she's had a neat birth, hasn't she?
Yeah.
She's had a nice one. Yeah. Like, straight.
You say 9 months apart, mate. Time, time your birth at 3 months, yeah. A tiny little fucking thing. Oh, sorry, what I'm talking about now. Anyway, what have you got anything to promote?
I don't know where that went.
Just done an awful freebie joke.
Yeah, that was weird.
It wasn't a joke. It wasn't a joke, just the idea of giving birth to a baby at like 14 weeks.
What? Why? What?
Because then, if they had the birth at 2 months, so 9 months apart, it wouldn't be.
I mean, I think
your maths has fucked yourself.
This is just about science that I think has gone horribly wrong here. But didn't we used
to? Very sad.
When we were Neanderthals, did we used to give, like, we've had to evolve to do about 9 months because women used to die. Like, yeah, Neanderthal women used to die because
of course.
They would gestate for too long and then we couldn't give.
And then they die from infection.
Yeah, it'd like, gestate for like a year and it would kill the women. So we had to evolve for 9 to 9 months.
Is that because, now my thinking there, you'd die in childbirth because of the risk of infection and everything, wouldn't you?
Still one of the most dangerous operations, isn't it? Even though it's not really an operation.
But yeah, that's like...
Because if you were giving birth in the fucking woods with no sanitary or anything, then you'd be like, oh, fucking hell.
Well, when I was doing NCT, which is like middle class pre-natal classes, the woman was like, there was one particular... class where she spent 15 minutes playing us a recording of a woman giving birth, a German woman giving birth in a field, to prove that you can give birth anywhere. But it was just a really, there's like 12 of us in a circle all trying not to make eye contact while we're listening to a woman moaning and yelping in a field. And there was so many, like, there was proper like football, like dads there just like constantly just like looking at the watches.
So James got a lovely new material gig started last week. At their gig last week, someone was saying that someone was an events manager on a cruise ship. And they said, what's the most eventful thing that's happened in cruise ships? Someone gave birth. Unexpectedly gave birth on the cruise ship. Like, oh, wow. What happened? It's like, well, we're out at sea. And none of the shops sold baby clothes. But we did have a Build-A-Bear. So for a week till she got off the ship, the baby was dressed in Build-A-Bear clothes.
I love that. So
I hope they called it Teddy. That would have been nice, wouldn't it? I don't know what the...
I didn't realise there's more on ships. Just I know that's the opposite end of the spectrum, but I didn't realise that. Tell me that works. I know, I was talking to somebody who works on a cruise ship, and I didn't know there's morgues on cruise ships.
Yeah.
Of course there is. They're just not on the map.
Jails, like, there'll be prisons as well, aren't there?
But of course, because a lot... quite a high percentage, not I love a cruise, but I'll have quite a high percentage of people that go on them are super old. So of course they've got... At least, I reckon, to every cruise ship, there's probably about 3,000 people on a cruise ship, maybe.
I love that.
A couple of people are going to pop the clogs, aren't they?
I love that. Like, just get them in the morgue. Let's carry on.
Let's crack on. I'd quite like to die on a cruise ship. I'd like a Viking. Like, I'd go out on the sea.
Bury me at sea. Just throw me overboard and crack on.
You were jumping off on a cruise ship when I went on the cruise. I was thinking, oh, this is horrible, this. But it was in my head all the time. Just like,
at any point, too many I just jump off.
And over, yeah. Just always like.
Is it like when you're on the top of a car park?
It is out there. So
you go on a cruise with family.
It's literally like you're going so fast, and you're like, if I fall, I'm in the darkness before I've even hit the ground, it's like so terrifying.
Just looking,
it's like, oh, this is so horrible.
You spent the whole cruise doing that.
No, we're just looking out at the ocean and thinking,
looking at
you. You're so fun to go on holiday with, Simon.
Under, won't you, if you landed you in that white bit?
I would love to go in all inclusive.
Oh, I get like a real my belly just dropped then, thinking about jumping off that thing. Going,
I love the idea of you sitting around having dinner with your mum and dad, just being like, looking in the eye, going, at any point I could ruin this for you.
Yeah.
Any point this cruise be ruined.
Oh, it terrifies me that.
Just understand that, okay?
Jumping off a cruise ship just by accident and regretting it instantly.
What, you want to do it by accident?
I know, because you get pissed and you think, this will be funny, this. I can make this and I'll get caught. Oh, God, no, it makes me so scared.
I'll climb on the other side.
What was I going to say then?
That's not even intrusive thoughts, mate. That's like just knobhead thoughts.
You've been up a skyscraper.
Nah.
And then you've got the little glass bit you can walk on. And I'm like, I'm like, yeah, if I just fell through here now, see you later.
Yeah.
I never think I'm going to fall, but I've, like, when you're at the top, top of the Empire State Building, go, nice place to just jump off of, It's the Empire State Building. Nice.
If you were going to kill yourself, how would you do it? Would you jump off a building?
Oh, it's a common theme, and we both know we're going to do it.
Oh, really? Have you already talked about this?
I'll send you the clip.
We'll send you the clip. His is lovely. Mine's very selfish. I want to go to my own funeral, basically. So I'm going to have it on the Friday and then chop myself on the Monday. I'm just going to kill myself on the Monday.
Can I say something?
Mine's the sea.
You want to just go to sea?
Yeah. But I'd like the ability to look back. I'd hopefully through some form of...
Take a Bluetooth speaker with you.
Thanks for coming.
Where's James going? With that Alexa?
And a mic. Is it say it's free to get in, not free to get out?
Why did you put that Alexa in a plastic bag? Yeah. Where's it going?
It's on the phone to Mr. Robinson. Sir!
Another way.
We love this one!
I would go out tonight.
James, what's that noise? Whoosh! Whoosh!
I'd like to know that what people would think of the thing.
What, you want to know that people would be sad about your death?
Yeah. And I'd like them to interview.
You could just fake.
Yeah, you want that interview. It could have been something.
Yeah.
You could just fake your death like that. Facebook. You could have another Facebook page dedicated to you. But it's your death.
That'd be great.
If anyone wanted to know what people thought about you, you'd just be like, oh, by the way, I need... Jay's passed away peacefully.
My fantasy is that the WhatsApp message to the first few people going, have you heard what's
Yeah, that's the bit I go,
that'd be lovely. That.
And then,
have you heard what's blowing his own head off? Oh, yeah.
And then anecdotes.
That's the bit that I
get. Have you heard what's jumped off that cruise ship?
Initial shock.
Yeah, and I'm like, fuck.
And you go, whoa.
Yeah. It culminates and then, it builds up and then you've got like the people doing anecdotes on Facebook.
No, the people who aren't even asked, they go, really? Oh, wow.
You want people that are indifferent to you to have a
just sort of like
reactions.
Someone goes, oh, what's
loads of comics trying to make puns.
And they go, oh, P&O, really?
Mate, P&O.
And then someone just goes, what time are we meeting at the pub? So the indifference of it, like, no, has he? What time are you getting? That.
We're part of like the UK female comics WhatsApp groups. So someone will go, have you heard Wozniak? Because then everyone will just be emojis, like party emojis.
All of them things like go, woohoo.
Fucking hell, I'll have a room in a green room now.
Is it Thompson or a Royal Caribbean? Which cruise ship was it?
No, there was definitely somebody. You've got to accept that, haven't you? As soon as you
die,
there was
a sea cat to Ireland.
People out there sending like over the moon.
Yeah, I think I'd be the type of death that would like warrant... but it would like warrant a Chortle article only for people to go, who?
Yeah. I'd wrote it.
Well, when I saw him...
I mentioned my own name in it 8 times.
He was shit.
Well, when I saw him in Bradford, he wasn't very funny.
Yeah.
One last death for old, wasn't he?
You'd be delighted that someone would not care that you were dead.
Steve Bennett reviewed my funeral. You need to come to terms with the fact that when you die, certain people are going to be over the moon.
No, yes. I'm a delight.
Over I know at least 5.
Yeah. I'm gonna
I don't know how many, they're gonna be delighted when you die because they'll be like, finally, he's at peace.
No more tension and sadness. That's why I want the fentanyl.
People still bully you on that thing. Post your stories of James on the thing. I remember we tried to drag him around by his fucking teeth with a magnet. Daft cunt.
I remember when you walked down the stairs going to DT, someone asked you, could you go any slower? And I did as a joke and they pushed me down the stairs.
Yeah. Getting called a daft cunt in the comments. Stupid cunt.
Yeah, but it was all banter though, wasn't it? Yeah. It was all banter.
Oh, You could take a joke.
We went part of that because it was natural causes. Yeah. It was all banter. I want at least 100 interactions.
At least 100.
Yeah. Do you ever do that on Facebook where you post a status and out of nowhere you're like,
you've gone viral.
Ooh, James.
32 likes.
35, mate. I stopped posting on Facebook about 10 years ago.
No, but like you get someone you used to school with like, oh, I didn't expect you to engage.
Are you still posting on Facebook?
Some now and then.
Again, there's times in life when you bring it on yourself.
Sorry, I just looked at my watch. Do you actually keep it in for 2 hours?
Well, no, 1 hour.
Are you going to keep all of this in?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, mate. Yeah. That's what we do.
Because you can't be asked to edit it.
No.
Well, people will.
Why? Why, what?
So you just keep everything in, you don't even cut to the best bits.
No, no, oh, no.
No.
It's not filet mignon. It's
people love it.
Blue.
People love it.
Avant-garde.
How do you like your podcast,
you
Blue?
Lazy bastards.
You're going to say twats then, but you're not a bastard.
I was going to say cunts, but then okay.
Just want to finish on a cunt.
Why don't you... Wait.
Oh, are we finishing
there's a joke
now,
there, there's a joke there about finishing on a cunt. I don't know.
Last time I finished on a cunt, that's why I'm in this situation. Come on.
Right.
Where are we finding you, James?
Come on.
Promote something.
You can find me on Twitter.
You still bringing your podcast out?
Okay. So.
Fingers, I feel like I'm bullying you.
No. You're the one that isn't. I've moved house now. So I've got an office.
A bit of fluff just came out your hair. Well done.
It was quite magical.
Yeah.
It was, yeah.
Almost like that's the, like a feather of somebody.
Yeah, wishing me on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's landed on the floor.
No, it's on
a metaphor there.
It's on you again. It's on your left tip.
Let him promote.
Yeah. Apply for that gig. the podcast, I've got an office now, so it's all set up for January. When does this go out, by the way?
Monday.
Monday, oh, okay.
What time are we on? Yeah, Tuesday morning.
Something I can't.
Midnight tonight.
Honestly, keep all of this in.
Actually, I'm on 27 on Instagram.
They fucking love it.
I was going to say something, but I don't want to spoil it because in case someone listens. Anyway.
Who doesn't love the extras?
Tuesday.
This has gone on.
Myself, Dean Coughlin, Callum Oakley.
I've been trying to finish it since 35.
A gig at Metricolor in Liverpool. Get on down to it. It's fun. Simon's doing it tomorrow. If you're going to be unlucky, following week this comes out. Yeah. So, retrospectively, we enjoy
it. I did it last week as well.
New stuff. Simon's gonna.
No, didn't mention how well I done last week.
Goat crime.
Rob smashed it. Sat down as well. Didn't stand up because he wasn't getting paid.
You real?
His dad wasn't there, so he could sit down.
All right, job Bishop.
And yeah, so come to that, and yeah, just follow me.
You should know where to find him by now. He's been on about 10 times.
Yeah, I've been. I want like a testimonial.
They found you and put you back.
Who has
listeners?
Oh, right, yeah. No, well, there's one guy on YouTube who keeps me up at night on one of them.
Right.
Because I got too scared. I think it's the one with Alfie Brown, and because I was too scared to speak because I didn't want to, like, and someone went, that James Allen was fucking shite. And it just, every now and then when I go to sleep, just when I'm about to drift off, that comment comes back and I'm like.
Oh, I love that. You were too scared to speak because you were so referential to Alfie. That's nice. The other guest.
No, it's fine, James.
It's fine, babe.
No, I flagged your show in 2016. You were really lovely to me. You've always been really nice.
Oh, God.
Kate Morgan, Saboteur. It was great. I loved it.
The one that no cunt was in.
It was brilliant. It was my first ever flyering job.
What was my favourite? My favourite moment was when... there was about 10 people in, and then I found out that downstairs all of the judges were just sat having a drink. They're just a social gathering.
Couldn't be asked.
Nothing even knew there was a show upstairs. They were just having a nice social drink.
Just shouting.
I've got nothing to promote. I'm not doing them.
Your baby,
I know, but it sells out every month.
Bring your own baby gigs, does it?
Yeah.
It sells out. Oh, nice.
Same crowd.
Comedy club. But if you live in if anyone here is a new mum who lives in Shortland in South Manchester.
Or a nonce. They don't check if you got a kid or not there.
Yeah, yeah.
No thanks.
Very lax.
Yeah. No nonces. No thanks. No thanks, please.
No nonces to the big girl. Imagine if you had that on the poster.
No sportswear.
I just can't believe I can't believe
no sportswear. No nonces.
Yeah. No Puma. No Lonsdale. No nonces.
I'm on Instagram. Yeah, find me on Instagram. I quit Twitter.
Yeah,
I found it quite negative. Although no one's really been negative to me, but I've just been like, I'm just jumped on the bandwagon. Like, it's too negative a space.
Yeah,
can't cope with it.
Right.
Oh, it's just because I can't get off my phone, and I wanted one less thing to go on. I'm a terrible scroller.
Yeah,
find me. I think I've got a Facebook page. I've not been on it for a bit.
The gram?
Facebook's dead.
Yeah, I'm on the gram at Katie Mulg.
You're on
Facebook's dead.
You're on TikTok?
You know what? I am, but I'm so sporadic with it. I do it like once every month and then I get stressed about what I'm going to post next, like I'm an actual influencer.
I need to go.
My hairdresser's, though, she's a big TikTok. She's got 30,000. People, I know. I
woke up tomorrow with 30,000 to kill myself.
What are you guys up to?
100,000.
Are you guys plugging?
Well, Rob's killing himself.
Only after Simon, because I promised them I'll send the text.
Merry Christmas, everyone. There's going to be a suicide pact happening. Yes.
No, they know.
Right, can we finish? Because I want to go home.
Yeah, no. She's dragging on a bit.
Pie.
What? I'm going to take one with me.
Okay.
You can press the button or not?
Oh, yes, sound. All right, thanks for listening, everyone. Keep supporting us on the Patreon.
Merry Christmas.
Love you all. Merry Christmas.